World Baseball Classic. In Tokyo Town, where round two has begun, and this is day one, which is turned tonight. The marquee matchup, Japan and the Netherlands. Come on through the Sadahara Oak Gate, and you'll land right in round two, Pool E. Japan is here, Cuba's here, Netherlands, and Israel as well. Hi, everybody. Rich Waltz, along with Buck Martinez. Earlier today, the darlings of the WBC, Israel, struck again. They beat Cuba by a score of 4-1. So Israel has gone 4-0 in the tournament so far. And Buck, last tournament in 2013, the Netherlands, they were the darlings of it all. And they dominated the Cubans. But when they ran into Japan, they ran into trouble. And that's who they've got tonight in the first game, second round.
Yeah, you know, Rich, you can bet that the Netherlands wants a little payback from 2013. Japan just really manhandled them. And tonight, they've got a different agenda on their minds. They want to get off to a good start in this tournament.
Some thought when the Netherlands got to San Francisco in 2013, if they had a little more pitching, they might have been able to get over the hump against the Dominicans, who ended up winning it all. Guess what? They've got a little more pitching here. Rick Vandenhurk, who didn't throw for them in 2013.
Yeah, Vandenhurk has major league experience, and he's really come on here late. He put everything together in Korea a couple of years ago, but you can see, originally signed by the Marlins, he had Tommy John surgery in 05. He threw almost 200 innings in the major leagues, and when he went to Korea, that's when he really developed as a pitcher. He spent the last 2 years pitching for the Fukuoka SoftBank Hawks here in Japan, so he knows what he's up against tonight. He knows every hitter in this lineup. He participated in 09 in the World Baseball Classic, but not in 13. He's anxious to get his team off to a good start tonight.
Speaking of good starts, Hiroki Kokubo's team is off to a terrific start. At 3-0, they swept through that first round. Hey, he said, yeah, we're all about pitching, defense, small ball. We can bunt, we can steal bases. But man, they can swing the bats too. They had power in that first round.
Well, they sure did. And they have a very balanced lineup. And they've got a big slugger in their lineup. Yoshitomo Tsutsugo, the left fielder, he hit home runs, 44 of them during the regular season, and so far in this tournament, he's got 2 homers and 5 RBIs. He's not only a power hitter, he's a very good hitter. But overall, this team has balance up and down the order. As a team, they hit over 300. They have 5 players with 3 or more hits in the series, 7 different players with RBIs, and a total of 6 home runs hit by 4 different players. This is a tough, tough lineup, and just for good measure, they threw in 5 stolen bases.
Partner, it's a tough, tough place to play for an opponent. There'll be 45,000. They'll be singing. They'll be chanting. They'll be watching as Japan and Netherlands open their second round. The sea of 45,000 goes Rick Vandenhurk. He gets the ball for the Netherlands. The Tokyo Dome, the big egg is jumping. It is electric here. This has the feel of a postseason game. And here is the lineup for Samurai Japan. It starts with Kosuke Tanaka, who gets his first start of this year's WBC. Ryosuke Kikuchi has been at second base. Nori Aoki, who's in the big leagues right now, is in right field. Yoshitomo Tsutsugo has been the talk of this round one and here hot going into round two. Sho Nakata has played well at first base. Hayata Sakamoto at shortstop has swung the bat and really picked it at short. Tetsudo Yamada, the DH. Shogo Akiyama gets a start in center field, and Seiji Kobayashi solid behind the plates.
31-year-old Rick Vandenberg will start tonight's game. He threw four scoreless innings in the first game in Korea. You see his numbers from a year ago here in Japan, pitching for the SoftBank Fukuoka Hawks. 13 starts, a 7-3 record. Overall, he's 16-3 in two seasons pitching here in Japan. He knows very well who he's facing tonight. He has faced many of these hitters. He's got a fastball slider, a good curveball, occasional changeup. He is 6'5", and that height gives him an advantage, a tough release point for these hitters to pick up on. And he learned the real value of pitching during his seasons in Korea. The Korean Baseball Organization is where he really developed, and that led to his signing with Fukuoka here in Japan.
And I said this feels like a postseason game. Guess what? He's pitched in a postseason game and successfully when SoftBank won the Japan Series. In 2015, Vandenberg was in that rotation. He got game two and pitched quite well in it. Ready to go, this place. If you haven't seen a game here, you're in for a real treat and a real ride. Kosuke Tanaka gets to start at third base. We'll start in the air. That is Randolph Odubor out there in left field. One pitch, one out. When you got a bunch of shortstops, your defense is going to be pretty good, and that's what you got with Netherlands.
Randolph Odubor is in left field. Jurickson Profar, he has made the transition very well into center. Valentin is in right. Bogarts and Simmons on the left side, and Scope at second base. Gold Glove caliber fielders in third, short, and second. Kurt Smith's at first, and Deschenko Ricardo, the veteran of this Netherlands team, behind the plate.
And Didi Gregorius, the DH tonight. Here is Kikuchi. Felix Tejada is calling balls and strikes. And you've got Larry Vanover at first, Corey Blazer at second, Trevor Grieve at third. And the Kikuchi chant and song begins. Fastball drilled center field. Profar on patrol is there and makes the catch. Hensley Meulens has done a wonderful job as the skipper of the Netherlands. And he's done a terrific job as the hitting coach for the three-time world champion San Francisco Giants. He's been at Bruce Bochy's side for the last 7 years. Wonderful to visit with, and a guy that I think deserves a shot at managing in the major leagues.
I agree with you 100%. Hensley Meulens deserves an opportunity to get a major league job. He knows baseball. He has played here in Japan. He's played in the big leagues, and he has learned an awful lot from Bruce Bochy.
Here is Aoki, and a fastball is a strike. It's 0-1. Aoki, of course, if you follow Major League Baseball, you know that he's been in the big leagues for some time. Houston will be his team this year. He's had some really nice moments over the last few years with the Royals, the Giants, the Mariners. Got his start in the big leagues with Milwaukee.
Aoki is now 35 years old, and he has done a nice job. He spent his first two seasons with the Milwaukee Brewers in 2012 and 13. Then he has played with the Royals, the Giants, the Mariners, and next, the Houston Astros.
Aoki, right field, deep, off the wall. Valentin has it, throw to second. A double.
That's the sixth double the Japanese team has hit in this tournament. And Aoki gets a fastball out over the plate. He turns on it. This ball had a chance to get out of the ballpark, but it hits high on the wall in right. He's able to get to second base with this double. Vladimir Valentin plays it very well, but he's got no shot at Aoki, who runs well.
Yoshitomo Tsutsugo. This is one guy that I think all the major league scouts who are here has really opened their eyes.
He is the reigning home run champ in the Central League, hit 44 home runs. He also led the league with 110 RBIs, and he's just 25 years old.
Oakie is at second. Vandenhert to the plate. That's a strike. Ricardo was set up outside. Vandenhert brought it across the inside part of the plate.
Tsutsugo plays for the Yokohama Bay Stars, and he's a native of Yokohama. He played in high school ball there. So he gets an opportunity that not many professional players get to do, and that's play in his hometown.
There's the breaking ball from Vandenhert. Vandenhert, really a fascinating story. Growing up in the Netherlands, he had three sports to choose from as a kid, and he chose baseball. He had judo and speed skating also on his list, but baseball was the choice. His dad was a baseball guy. And Vandenhert gets Tsutsugo, 84 miles an hour on a beautiful changeup. This game's underway, scoreless. This is the second round and the first day. Earlier today, the incredible ride of Israel continued. They took down Cuba. The Netherlands now takes aim at Japan. Look at this lineup. Andrelton Simmons is at short. Jurickson Profar actually is in center field. Xander Bogaerts, the all-star from the Red Sox, is at third base. And Vladimir Valentin, who has had an incredible career here in Japan, hitting home runs in the cleanup spot. Didi Gregorius, the DH. Jonathan Schoop at second, Kurt Smith at first, Toshenko Ricardo behind the plate, and Randolph Odubor is in left field. Simmons steps out and gets ready to go here. Bottom of the first, scoreless. First pitch, Ayumi Ishikawa.
Ishikawa pitches for the Chiba Lotte Marines. He opened up this series for Japan against Cuba, and you can see his record in 23 games a year ago, 14-5, a very good earned run average. And notice the walks, just 22 walks and 162 and a third. He throws it over. He's got a pretty good fastball, a little better velocity than you might expect, but he's got outstanding control, as those 22 walks would suggest.
Now, Simmons isn't a guy you would expect in the leadoff spot if you were in the American League, but for this team, he's been a real catalyst up top. Three hits in Korea. He was especially a catalyst, remember, in 2013. And when it came down to it, in an elimination game, the Netherlands against Cuba, the winner goes to San Francisco, the loser goes home. Cuba had a two-run lead in the bottom of the eighth, and Simmons hit a two-run homer to tie the game. The Netherlands would walk off in the bottom of the ninth. And so he's in the leadoff spot, followed by an awful lot of major league talent. And Ishikawa has gone 3-0.
Well, and Simmons will probably have a green light. He's got some pop, especially in this tournament. 17 home runs in the big leagues in 2013 for the Braves. Andrelton gets so much recognition because he's a terrific shortstop, two-time Gold Glove winner. But he's a 261 career hitter in the big leagues. Last year with the Angels, he hit 281.
There's a chopper over the mound. Sakamoto. Japan has a good shortstop as well. And he'll be playing defense behind Ayumu Ishikawa.
Take a look at the scouting report for Ishikawa. He's got a fastball and a shuto. That's a pitch unique to Japan. It's a running ball that comes inside to right-handed hitters, a slider and a curveball. He's a ground ball pitcher. Eight of his 12 outs in the game against Cuba were ground ball outs. And because he's had that good start under his belt, he's pitching with a lot of confidence here. And the manager, Kokubo, has picked him to start the second round as well.
Breaking ball starts the at bat for Jurickson Profar. If you're looking for a hitting hero, in Korea as Netherlands advanced. This is the guy, Profar, right now just 24, out of Curacao, and property of the Texas Rangers.
Wow.
You want bat speed? Look at that.
Profar's been plagued by shoulder issues, and he missed a couple of seasons. Last year, he got into 90 games with the Texas Rangers, but he is an offensive threat. You can see how that bat flies through the hitting zone, and Profar, they're hopeful in Texas that he's going to be healthy. He's a switch hitter and a very versatile player, as his start in center field would suggest.
And with all the shortstops that Hensley Mullins had, there wasn't a real concern as to who would play short. I think everybody, all the other shortstops said, well, that's Simmons. But he was interested to see about Profar in the outfield, where he may play some with the Rangers. And Profar called him and said, hey, I want to play center field. He had thought about putting him in left. Called up the Texas Rangers to say, hey, are you okay with him in center field? And got the green light.
Yeah. Hensley Mullins called up Jeff Banister and said, hey, Profar's approached me about playing center. Are you good with that? He said, I'm good with him playing anywhere. I want him to get as many repetitions as possible because he's missed so much time. And he is a very talented hitter and a young player that's got a lot of good baseball ahead of him.
2-2. Oh, he chases off speed pitch. And Ishikawa strikes out Profar.
A little bit different look for Team Japan defensively in this game tonight against the Netherlands. Tsutsugo is still in left field. Shogo Akiyama, a center fielder, moves over. Aoki has played center field exclusively in this tournament, moves to right. Tanaka gets a start at third. He's a natural shortstop. Sakamoto and Kikuchi up the middle. Sho Nakada is at first, and Keiji Kobayashi is the catcher for Ishikawa.
All right, now Bogarts, who really blossomed last year with the Red Sox. His third full season, 21 homers, 34 doubles, was an all-star and a deserving one, won another Silver Slugger. He's 1-2.
Yeah, he's going to be pretty good when he grows up. Last year, all-star Silver Slugger, played at 23 years old for the Red Sox, got 719 plate appearances. He had 294. I mean, he's got it all. 34 doubles, 21 home runs, and 89 RBIs.
Check swing at a breaking ball.
Rich, you and I have been around this team, and you see the most hits in the major leagues since the start of 2015. A great second baseman, Jose Altuve, who's playing for Venezuela in the WBC. Then Xander Bogarts. His teammate, Mookie Betts, they are tied at 388 hits. Robinson Cano fourth on that list.
And as Mullins was talking to all the infielders about playing in 2017, he didn't have to ask the question of Bogarts. Bogarts said, hey, Skip, I'll play third. And he said, I know I'm one of the best shortstops in the American League, but I can't play shortstop on this team because Andrelton Simmons is here.
Yeah, and with D.D. Gregorius, the starting shortstop for the Yankees, he takes a back seat to Andrelton Simmons. They all tip their cap to Andrelton Simmons as far as the shortstop position.
Bogart's got a breaking ball, chops it. Tanaka in time. Ishikawa answers with a 1-2-3 inning. Tokyo Dome tonight. Round two begins. Into the second round here of the World Baseball Classic. Tokyo first, San Diego soon. Two teams from each first round pool advanced here. Two teams from Tokyo, two teams from San Diego will end up at Dodger Stadium for the championship. Pitch count limit, second round, 80 pitches per game. And it's pool play. So first and second round, everybody plays three games. Two best teams advance. Single elimination when they get to Dodger Stadium. And Japan here probably feels a little odd since they are the visiting team in their home ballpark and their home crowd. Nakata, Sakamoto, and Yamada against Vandenhert. His fastball misses up. Felix Tejada is out of the Dominican Republic, a seasoned International League umpire.
Vandenberg has a good fastball to start this game. He's been able to locate that fastball right at the top of the strike zone, and that could be problematic for these Japanese hitters. He has that good riding fastball that has tied up a couple of the hitters early in this game.
Buck, anytime you get a tall pitcher, and Vandenberg stands at 6'6", who delivers the ball high, almost over the top, that can be problematic for hitters. And I want you to explain why.
As a breaking ball found out. Well, Rich, first of all, when you look at Vandenberg, he's 6'5", standing on the mound, so he presents an imposing figure. But then he extends high over his right shoulder, and that's a difficult angle for the hitters to pick up on. You have a tendency to see just the top half of the baseball, and it can create a lot of problems for you. He also throws that curveball out of the same release point, so that's a real challenge for these hitters.
There's the curve, and it's fair by Bogarts into the corner. Nakata around first, and he arrives at second. A leadoff double for Japan.
Nakata has the most at bats of any Japanese hitter in this lineup against Vandenberg. 4-for-18 coming into this ball game, and that's why Kokubo kept him in the batting order. He's familiar with Rick Vandenberg. He has seen this curveball before, and that breaking pitch stayed on the inner half of the plate, and Nakata was able to keep it fair for the double.
Now Sakamoto, the shortstop, shows bunt, drops it down, Smith to first in time. So Japan tries to play small ball here. They give up an out for 90 feet of real estate. And now Tetsuro Yamada, the DH, has to make it pay off.
Kokubo asked the batting champ in the Japanese Central League to drop down a sacrifice bunt with a runner in scoring position. Sakamoto hit 344 last year, but Hiroki Kokubo says, you know what, we need to get on the board first. So he advances the runner from second to third, asking the batting champ to bunt.
Infield's in. Tetsuro Yamada now. Yamada, the DH. We saw him at the top of the lineup in round one. In the dirt, and Dashenko Ricardo knocks it down. Ricardo is just about every catcher we've seen in the World Baseball Classic over here is a really good catch, throw, technician, block the ball. Managers in this tournament have put a premium on that position defensively.
Ricardo can really catch and throw, and you saw his blocking skills on that curveball in the dirt.
Yamada, an incredible combination of speed and power right now. And he's only 24.
Yeah, Yamada has certainly captured the attention of Major League scouts. You look at the package he brings to this ball club. He was the MVP in 2015. Last year, he had 38 home runs and stole 30 bases.
2-0. Breaking ball. And Felix Tejada's strike zone, not to the Netherlands' liking.
Yeah, this is a slider. It looks like a pretty good pitch. And Dashenko Ricardo does a nice job of presenting that pitch well to the umpire, but they didn't get the call.
Misses in. Japan now with runners at the corners and one out. And Shogo Akiyama, the center fielder, is the hitter.
This is truly an all-star lineup top to bottom. Akiyama starting for the first time in this series. A natural center fielder. He has played all of his team's games in three of the last four seasons. And this is his first start. That just shows you how much talent there is on his team.
And this is the guy that now has the single season hit record here in Japan. 216 in only 143 games. And some think, well, he must have broken Ichiro's record. Actually, Ichiro is third on that list. Matt Merton, the former Cub, had 214 hits in 144 games in 2010. Akiyama had 216 in 15. Ichiro back all the way back to 1994 at 210, but Ichiro did it at only 130 games.
Why doesn't that not surprise me? It's amazing what Ichiro was able to do.
Runner goes, swing and a miss, and no throw to second. Japan swipes their sixth base in game number four of this World Baseball Classic.
Rich, when we first got here to Japan, there was a lot of concern about the offense of Samurai Japan, but no problem at all. They're scoring runs, they're stealing bases, they're hitting home runs, and they have now stolen six bases. Ricardo, no chance at all to make a throw.
Infield in again. Liner to left, hit well. Odeberg has it. Runner tags from third. Nakata scores.
When you get a leadoff double, chances are you're going to score, but Hiroki Kokubo, the Japanese manager, didn't leave anything to chance. He asked Sakamoto to drop down the sacrifice punt, and Akiyama, the all-time hit leader here in Japan for a single season, picks up the sack fly. Japan leads it.
Now the catcher, Seiji Kobayashi, who's in the ninth spot. Yamada, who can run, is still at second. And Vandenhert gets a strike.
Kobayashi, not known for his bat, has had a good series. 3-for-6 with a homer and three ribbies.
And he's known for his glove and for handling pitchers. And he does it for the Yomiuri Giants, who are the flagship team of NPB, Nippon Professional Baseball. And this is their home ballpark.
Vandenhert's made some good pitches with his slider down and away, but hasn't gotten the calls.
Fastball is out. Now remember, this is an offset center field camera, so we're not looking right down the chute in line with the bag at second, the mound, and the plate. So a pitch on the outside part can be tough to decipher.
Yeah, you can see the dramatic angle. Camera coming almost over Simmons' back. Cameras are off to the left field side of center.
2-1. And that's not by design for those that televise baseball. It's actually by design for those that build ballparks. Depending on where ballparks, both here in Japan or in Major League Baseball.
Jerickson Profar playing in center field is looking in the dugout for Andrew Jones' advice on how deep he should play, and he's pretty shallow right now.
That one foul back to the screen.
Andrew Jones coach on this team has done a terrific job with these players, and you can see he's right there at the top step. He is certainly Hensley Mullins' lieutenant. And Hensley told us, I don't have to worry about a thing in the outfield. Andrew Jones has him covered.
Well, the last time we saw the Netherlands in this ballpark, Andrew Jones was scoring a walk-off run and then being held back from charging the Cuban dugout. Here's a 2-2. I've never seen that in all my days of baseball. It was a dramatic scene. The Netherlands in an elimination game. Winner went to San Francisco. Loser went home. Jones finishing his career, international career with Netherlands. He would play in Japan the next 2 years. Was at third base. And Kalian Sams hit a sacrifice fly. It scored Jones. He crossed the plate and he kept going towards the Cuban dugout. He and Victor Mesa, the manager, had a running feud going the entire round. Oh, gorgeous breaking ball from Vandenhert to finish the inning. But Japan scores first. Sho Nakata, a double. It's 1-0. And this was the last time the Netherlands was here. That's the sack fly from Sams. Andrew Jones, a walk-off win. And look at Jones headed towards the Cuban dugout. The Netherlands, the darlings of 09, went even a step further in 13. They got to the final round. They lost to the Dominican, who would win it all. And Andrew Jones, outstanding major league career. And he had a couple of really good seasons here, Buck Martinez, after that 13 World Baseball Classic. Vladimir Balintin is so close to Andrew Jones, bounces out on the first pitch he sees from Ishikawa.
Ishikawa did a nice job of taking something off that last breaking pitch and had Balintin out in front. Balintin hasn't had an extra base hit so far in this tournament. He is 5-for-10 now, but they've all been singles.
D.D. Gregorius. Now, Gregorius did not get to play in that 13 World Baseball Classic. He had an elbow injury. But he is here now and extremely happy to be here. Gregorius quietly had a really nice year last year, especially offensively for the Yankees.
Well, Didi Gregorius can really play shortstop, but you're right. He had 20 home runs and drove in 70 runs playing for the Yankees in his second season. And remember, he had the pressure of replacing Derek Jeter coming over and playing shortstop after Derek Jeter retired. And it was a pretty tough task, but he has settled in very, very well and teamed up with Starlin Castro, his second base partner. D.D. Gregorius came up with Cincinnati in 2012 for just 8 games, went to Arizona for a couple of years. But he's a terrific player.
And all this talent, the gold gloves of Simmons, the world championship for Bogarts, and an all-star appearance. Scope in his big year, 25 homers. Gregorius and all the things that he's been able to do. Profar coming off the injury now. Here's the amazing thing. Simmons is 27. Profar is 24. Bogarts is 24. Scope is 25. Gregorius is 27. Busted bat and a roller to first. I mean, they are all in the prime of their career and the younger end of that prime.
Well, Didi Gregorius and Anderson Simmons are like brothers. They've been playing baseball since they were 8, 9 years old. Both of their fathers have coached them from time to time. And they hang out together. They play chess together. They play cards together. Hensley Mullins said, I go back to the hotel. Andrew Jones has all these kids in his room playing cards, playing chess. They just compete and they hang out together all the time. And Andrew Jones has been a terrific mentor to these young players from the Netherlands.
Well, you want another connection? Here is Jonathan Scope. Jonathan Scope and Jurickson Profar, teammates when they were young, and they just happened to win the Little League World Series for Curacao back in 2004. In fact, Scope, second baseman with the Orioles, was the closer for that team and closed the championship game.
Well, to give you an idea, you know, when you have this many talented players and many of them play shortstop, Bogarts, Gregorius, and Simmons, and oftentimes you would think, well, you know, there's going to be some bruised egos, but they're so close. They say, hey, Anderton's a shortstop. DG, I'll do whatever you want. Bogart said, play me at third. And they're always about team first on this ball club. It's really made the job very easy for Hensley Mullins.
Breaking ball, ripped to left, and deep, and gone, and tied. Jonathan Scope, a rocket out of here, and his teammates spill out of the dugout. It's 1-1.
Jonathan Scope played all but three innings for the Orioles last year at second base, and he has really developed into a very good hitter. You're going to watch this at bat and watch how he stays back. It's a curveball. He extends with that bottom hand and drives it over the wall in left. Jonathan Scope is a big man. Is getting stronger and stronger with every season. A terrific two-way player. Defensively, he's improved dramatically. And last year, he had 25 home runs for the Orioles.
Kurt Smith takes a rip. And it's 0-1. And Ishikawa giving up a home run to Jonathan Scope. Kurt Smith, left field. Did he get it? Tetsugo makes the catch at the wall. The inning is over, but the Netherlands strikes. Jonathan Scope. You had to think it would be one of the shortstops, right? It's 1-1. 4 years ago, this is Jonathan Scope at 21 in the 2013 World Baseball Classic. He is now a grown man. That was when he was 21. He's now 25. He is strong and big. What is he, 6'3", 220?
Yeah, weighs about 225, and as we mentioned, he plays every day at second base. I mean, every day. He missed just three innings in the field for the Orioles last season.
Well, if they have a major league second baseman cage match, I'm taking Jonathan Scope.
I tell you what, these young athletes for the Netherlands, they're impressive with their athletic prowess.
Japan now, Vandenhoek not getting that breaking ball. That's been the toughest pitch for him to get from home plate umpire Felix Tejada. Counts 2-0. Kosuke Tanaka flied out back to the first.
All of these chants are personalized for the hitter. In the major leagues, of course, Rich, we have walk-up songs. These chants go on throughout the entire at bat.
Because this is essentially the Japanese League All-Star team, the lyrics and these songs come from all the different ballparks around the league. So it's impressive that everybody here is able to sing along and get on the same page. That's a swing, and that's a strikeout. Vandenhoek has punched out three.
Rick Vandenhoek continues to throw that slider. It's been a good pitch for him, but as you mentioned, Rich, he hasn't gotten many called strikes with it. But he knows he has to continue to mix it into the approach he uses against this lineup. Remember, they are very, very meticulous in their preparation for games. He's pitched here for two seasons, so they know all about it.
Here's Bucci. And of course, Vandenhoek has teammates on this team. Ironically, a couple of those guys not in the lineup. Nobuhiro Matsuda, who had a great first round, and Seiichi Uchikawa are both SoftBank Hawks in Fukuoka.
Well, the manager, Kokubo, decided, hey, they're a teammate, so they haven't faced him. So I'm going to go ahead and get guys up there that have faced him. And it paid off with Sho Nakata, who had a double and scored the first run. Nakata with 18 advanced during the regular season against Vandenberg.
That's going to be a tough play. And a base hit for Ryosuke Kikuchi.
Right off the end of the bat, Bogarts gave it a shot with a barehanded grab, but this is a curveball. He hits right off the end of the bat, bounces it right in front of the plate. Bogarts, just a do or die chance. I don't know, even if he comes up with it cleanly, if he had a shot. Kikuchi aboard with an infield swinging bunt.
All right, this is game four for Japan in the World Baseball Classic, and they have stolen six bases already. And Aoki doubled in the first.
Aoki hit a fastball three quarters of the way up off the fence in right. Vandenberg with a runner at first would love to be able to throw him a breaking ball, but there's a big hole on the right side of the infield.
Now, way back in 2005 when Aoki was here, he broke the 200 hit barrier and had 202 hits in 146 games. And at the time, that was second to Ichiro.
Aoki playing in his third World Baseball Classic. He played in 06 and 2009. Long career here with the Yokosuka Swallows.
Vandenhoek is starting to mix in a little more of that changeup. When he started to play baseball, Vandenhoek was actually a catcher. Runner goes. Pitches down low. And another stolen base.
Well, they picked a good pitch to run on. It was a breaking ball, and Ricardo had to block the ball. No thoughts whatsoever of making a play. Good break at first by Kikuchi. Ball is in the dirt, and the catcher has no choice but to block it. Another stolen base.
Aoki hit a fastball. And he blasted it off the wall and right. It was back in the first.
You mentioned Vandenhoek began his career as a catcher. There's another player that played in WBC for the Netherlands that started his career as a catcher. Kenley Jansen, now the closer of the Dodgers. And he was a big guy as well, like Vandenhoek.
The Dodgers were not keen on Jansen joining this team in Korea or here. But you never know. If they get to Dodger Stadium, it's Dodger Stadium.
It's a home game.
Diving stop. Bogarts will hold it. That saved a run.
What great reactions by Xander Bogaerts, who plays shortstop for the Red Sox. He clearly saves a run. That ball was headed down the left field line. Clearly an RBI base hit for sure. Pops up, looks at the runner, and decides he has no chance at Aoki. But Aoki guides this down the third base line, and Bogaerts saves a run for Vandenhert for the time being.
Two infield hits, and now you got Big Thunder at the plate. Yoshitomo Tsutsugo. And the Tsutsugo chant begins. Remember, he played for Yokohama. In round one, we read the chant. And moments later, he blasted one of the seats. You want to give it a try again? Here is the chant and the song. High into the Yokohama sky, blast us a home run, Tsutsugo. Come on, hit it, Tsutsugo. Blast it to the back of the sky.
Great atmosphere here at the Tokyo Dome. Tsutsugo drove in the first run of this tournament for Team Japan, a first inning single on a breaking ball against Cuba.
I had a chance to visit with the Japanese manager today, Hiroki Kokubo, and ask him about this hitter. And what impresses him the most is the fact that he's not just a pull hitter. He will drive the ball middle. He'll drive the ball to the opposite field. He does not have a complicated swing. Kokubo felt that that was important to keeping him rolling. And the guy in front of the Japanese manager, the first guy in your shot there, Atsunori Inaba, knows a thing or two about being a left-handed slugger. He was a great one for a long time in this league. Saw the batting average. So this isn't a guy that is an all or nothing guy. He had a 430 on base percentage last year. And his OPS, well, anytime it's four digits, it's good. 1100.
Tsutsugo played in 10 games in the Dominican Republic in 2015 in their winter league. He lays off that pitch, and you could see how he tracked it so well right into the catcher's glove. We have seen this time and time again during his at-bats. He's got a good eye.
The guy you compare him to in Major League Baseball is Jim Tobin.
Oof. Little cutter right there tied him up. I see the comparisons because he has the same body type, big, stocky, strong guy, but he is quiet at the plate. This cutter is up and he swings over top of it. But like Tomy, Tsutsugo has power to the opposite field.
I think that's the first time the whole tournament we've really seen him come out of his shoes and almost stumble out of the box. Here's a 2-2. Vandenhert stays out. All right. Does Japan start the runners here?
I think they will. They've got Kikuchi at second. He is there with a stolen base, and Aoki runs well. He's at first. Start the runners, just trying to avoid hitting into a ground ball double play. Create some movement on the infield.
Vandenhert ready. Runners hold. Tsutsugo fouls it back. Tsutsugo is listed at 6 feet, 210 pounds. Did he go? Yes. Trevor Grieve, the third base umpire, says swing.
Trevor Grieve is from Canada, and he's got a lot of world baseball experience as an umpire, and indeed that is a swing from Tsutsugo. He went too far, couldn't check his swing on that slider.
Big strikeout for Vandenberg, who through all of this, Buck, has run his pitch count up to 51 pitches. And remember, this is second round. His limit is 80.
Already he has eliminated himself from making a second appearance throwing 51 pitches. He has to have 4 days off after 51 pitches, but he can pitch deep into this game, throw as many as 80.
Speaking of that, I hope Bruce Chinn is feeling better. The lefty that was going to start for China the other night, felled by the flu. Was very sick, had to stay in his hotel room. What a wonderful man. And I hope wherever he goes and whatever he chooses to do from now on, he has success. Runners not running, that one fouled back.
You know, in the early game today, Jason Marquis started. He and Bruce Chinn were teammates in the Braves organization, and throughout the first round they were texting one another, hoping to maybe meet up in round two here in Tokyo.
A 20 pitch second. That's where Japan got their first run. He's up to 23 this inning. Nakata drives it left field. Odubert back at the wall. Gone! Three run shot. Shown. For Nakata, he's doubled and homered, and the lead is 3 for Japan.
We mentioned Sho Nakata coming into this game had the most at bats against Rick Vandenberg, and he is 2 for 2. This is a fly ball. He gets under it, but gets enough of it to hit it into the first row of seats in left. He stays on that slider. It's a high fly ball just deep enough for the 3-run home run. He has a double, a homer, and driven in 2.
This is not a big ballpark, and it plays smaller when it's full and it warms up. 400 feet to straightaway center, but the gaps are only 361 feet. You can see left field and right field, 13 feet is the wall.
Well, Nakata's a legitimate home run hitter. He spent 8 years here. He's had over 160 career home runs. He had 30 home runs in 2015. That's his career high.
Sakamoto walks. Now Vandenberg, 59 pitches, has hit a major speed bump. And our old friend Bert Blyleven is on his way out, the pitching coach, and a very successful pitching coach for the Netherlands. Obviously a legend.
Hall of Famer. Bert Blyleven takes a lot of pride in helping out these young pitchers.
Born in the Netherlands is Blyleven. 287 wins. Pitched for 2 world champions. And of course, in the Hall of Fame in 2011. This is his 3rd World Baseball Classic. And you know, you talk about all the talent that they have as far as position players. Blylevin in 09 and 13 had to patch together a pitching staff that didn't have a lot of star power to it.
Think about Markwell, a left-hander, veteran of all four World Baseball Classics, loosening up. Blylevin always tells his pitcher, when you're in doubt, go down and away with a fastball. That's the toughest pitch to handle.
The crowd, the songs, the chants have a little more gusto now after the three-run homer by Nakata. Markwell's pace undoubtedly will quicken.
Markwell, a former farmhand of the Toronto Blue Jays. Blue Jays signed him when he was 16 years old. Rick Blylevin obviously very concerned right now as the Japanese are sending up the eighth hitter this inning.
Shogo Akiyama, and he fouls it at the plate. There are two outs, and there have been two outs for a while. Remember the strikeout of Sutsugo? That kept the runners at first and second, but Nakata blasted one over the wall and left. Sakamoto and Yamada have reached.
He's a tough guy to strike out here. He has a tendency to put the bat on the ball, as we mentioned, a terrific hitter. He has picked up a sack fly already within the first run of the game.
To center. Profile on a hop. Sakamoto will score. 5-1.
Akiyama stays on this high fastball and rips it into center field. A batter round inning for Team Japan as they have cashed in four runs so far. Two RBIs for Akiyama, getting his first start in this WBC.
Hensley Mullins, one foot on the field, two hands on the rail. Kobayashi, half swing. Bogarts to second. Scope is there. Nine men usual. I think this is the third curtain call we've seen from him.
Yeah, anytime a player hits a home run or has a dramatic at bat during an inning, a crowd acknowledges it and they don't stop their applause until the player tips their cap and acknowledges the crowd. So Nakata, he's done that quite a few times in this tournament already.
I guess it's the equivalent of a curtain call.
Exactly.
That you see in some major league ballparks. Ricardo, the catcher, Sakamoto. Boy, I know we've got a lot of great shortstops here for the Netherlands, but this guy is special too.
Sakamoto is 28 years old. He won the Golden Glove in 2016 to go along with a batting title. He hit 344 and drove in 75 runs and, just for good measure, won the Golden Glove.
Here's Randolph Odeber out of Aruba. You know, Rawlings sponsors the Gold Glove in Major League Baseball. I thought that Mizuno would be a lock to sponsor the Golden Glove, but it's Mitsui, which is a conglomerate here in Japan, a trading company. So not Mizuno, although Mizuno, Buck Martinez, if you have a chance here in Tokyo, get yourself to the Mizuno store and see all the cool stuff, much like a giant Nike town.
You can see the Mizuno logo on the side of the cap, Sakamoto, as they have sponsored Team Japan's uniforms, and they are really classic uniforms.
Odeber pulls that one foul.
One of the things I think that's been really impressive has been the coaching staff jackets. They have these beautiful jackets and track suits for the trainers and the extra assistants. You can see the jacket, number 72, that's Gando, the pitching coach. They've done a great job with their unis.
Oh, you're right. I mean, it's sweet. How much do you think that jacket would run you up at the Samurai Japan team store or at the Mizuno store if you go there in downtown Tokyo?
Yeah, and it'll be 12, 13,000 yen at least. But it is sharp.
One, two. Odeber. Now, those are the excite seats, and they're loaded with folks. It's inside the screens, which ring the playing field. And so I know if you've watched a few games here this year, we've described it. For those of you that are just happening by this site, a helmet and a glove await the fans in each seat, so you can choose to protect yourself with a helmet and a glove.
They also have ushers down in those seats that will blow whistles on pop-ups. When those line drives come in there, they don't have time to go to their whistles.
I like the idea.
I love the idea, especially for the youngsters. They have helmets down there, and you know, you get distracted from time to time, and those line drives, they rocket into those seats.
That's into right field. Let's see if Odeber is able to stretch it. Aoki can throw, and Odeber can run. And he's in there with a one-out double as the Netherlands tries to claw their way back towards Japan.
Well, they certainly have a lot of offense in this lineup. And the number nine hitter, Odeber, 2-for-8 in the first round in Seoul, Korea, stays back and slices this past the first baseman, Nakata, down into the corner. Odeber is the left fielder, and he hustles around the bag and makes it into second ahead of the throw from Aoki.
And so Odeber is out at second. Here's Simmons. Simmons into right field. That's a hit. Aoki was deep, and they're going to send Odeber, and he's going to come home. I'm not sure why Aoki was so deep, but he was way back near the warning track. Simmons easily scores Odeber, and just like that, the Netherlands has a run.
Yeah, there's a lot of thunder in this lineup for the Netherlands, and Andrelton Simmons jumps on the first pitch and rips it into right. But you're right, Aoki was awfully deep out there. He had no shot whatsoever at throwing out the runner scoring from second, Odeber.
So Odeber starts it, and Aoki playing a little more shallow, and here's Profar. Odeber has, in my mind, the best nickname here, the Groovin' Aruban.
They've got some nicknames for sure. Even the manager, Mullins, he's Bam Bam.
That was early in his career. Profar tries the bunt, and he pops it foul. You're right, Hensley, Bam Bam, Mullins. There's a Odeber on the right.
Valentin behind Jonathan Scope. They call him Coco. And he's a big-time slugger here. He has led the league three consecutive seasons in home runs, capped off by a record 60 home runs in 2013.
Profar had an enormous series up in Korea. In the three games, he was 6-for-11, a homer, drove in three, two doubles, stole a base. And thank goodness this young man is healthy, because that torn labrum he had wiped out 2 years, 2014 and 15. That's scorched, and it's off the glove of Nakata. It's a fair ball. Simmons is on his way to third base. Holding first is Profar, and the Netherlands has come out swinging.
Number nine hitter Odeberg hit a one-out double. He's come in to score. Now Profar hits it off Nakata's glove at first base, inside the bag. Got a glove on it, bounces off his glove down the right side. You can see the hesitation as Profar came out of the box. Then he has to throw on the break. Simmons goes first to third on the base hit, and the Netherlands team has something going right here. And now they've got Xander Bogaerts. They can come back from any deficit for sure. They've got a lot of depth in this lineup.
It was a 1-1 game. Japan put four on the board in the top of the inning. Three hits. A run so far. Now Japan, if they can get a ground ball from Bogaerts, can get out of the inning. But Bogaerts obviously trying to drive in this run. Japan's outfield is extremely deep.
Bogaerts hit .320. For the Red Sox in 2015. He missed hitting .300 last year, hit .294, but boy, the power has really come around. 21 home runs a year ago.
There is a strike. In the Kingdom of the Netherlands, if you do something special, you get knighted. And I think all these guys are knighted by now. Bogaerts was part of that World Cup championship team of 2011. Part of the World Championship team for Boston as a rookie. Played a lot in that World Series, remember? A couple silver sluggers, all-star last year. In the air, I don't think that's going to get it done. Aoki's got a head of steam. Runner tags. That's Simmons. He's coming. The throw. And he is safe. Just got in there. Boy, Simmons was flying down the line. It was a good throw from Aoki. Kobayashi argued, but he looked like he was in.
Not that deep and right, but Aoki has time to set up underneath and gets his momentum headed toward home. Watch the hand. Simmons slides his left hand across the plate. And here's the reaction in the bullpen. You think these guys don't care? Two runs in the inning after they gave up a four spot in the top of the third.
And a heads up move by Profar, who ends up at second. And so now Ballantyne, the big slugger, who's had such a great run here in Japan. And he takes a fastball for a strike. Ballantyne is out of Curacao. He did get to the major leagues with Seattle and Cincinnati, but it wasn't until he got here that he really took off. And in 2013, with 60 home runs, he wiped out the record held by Sadahara Oh of 55 homers in a season. And Ballantyne did it in 130 games.
Well, you remember in 2013 during the World Baseball Classic, he had a very significant groin injury. And that cost him to the start of the season over here in Japan. But he got healthy and obviously put up big numbers as he's led this league in home runs three consecutive seasons.
Ballantyne, a blast! Gone! My goodness! It's tied! Like a rocket.
17 have not had an extra base hit in this tournament so far until that shot. No question about it. The only thing in doubt was whether or not it was going to be fair or foul. And it hits high up on the foul pole down the left field line. This is a shot. And he's standing there at home wishing it to be fair. And indeed, it hits the foul pole. And he knows he got it all. And it's a brand new ball game.
How awesome is that? That's Carlton Fisk with a Caribbean flair.
This team's got a lot of offense, and Ballantyne, once he gets it going, look out.
Both starting pitchers are just stunned right now. Ishikawa and Vandenberg. Both have given up a four spot here in the third inning.
They both scored single runs in the second. Japan looked like they were going to have a comfortable lead, and Ballantyne caps off their own four-run inning.
You hear the term turning on a pitch and opening up the hips.
He had seasons of 31, 31, and 60 to lead his league in home runs three consecutive seasons.
Gregorius, the 2-1.
Here's an example of how you get the head out. He opened up the hips and drilled it. All he's thinking about, just stay fair, baby.
I'm telling you, that's a modern-day Carlton Fisk with an island groove. That's outside, and Gregorius walks. And you know what? We talked about it last night. In this international tournament, you have countries who have a different style. Japan has their unique style. Korea has a unique style. Dominican, Puerto Rico, and certainly the Netherlands. And Japan's got double barrel action in their bullpen. That one to center. Akiyama's there, and it makes the catch. The Netherlands gets up off the canvas, and Vladimir Ballantyne with a Ballantyne blast. It's 5-all. Amsterdam, if you've not been, what a great city. Famous for the windmills, the tulips. 1,200 windmills are still around. Cool hats, too. And the baseball has grown and grown. The islands seem to produce a lot of shortstops. There's plenty on this team. Diegomar Markwell takes over for Rick Vandenberg. He's got the top of the order for Japan. Markwell is a veteran of international play. He had a really nice run in 2013.
Markwell, you see his numbers with the Curacao team, 14 starts. He signed with the Toronto Blue Jays as a 16-year-old, pitched in the New York Penn League in St. Catharines. Pretty good breaking pitch, didn't get the call. He made it all the way up to AA in 2002, and I've known Markwell for a while. He played with my son in the Blue Jays minor league system, but he's still pitching in the Netherlands, and very proud of his contribution to this organization.
A little grounder to third, and Bogaerts just in time to get the leadoff man, Kosuke Tanaka. Markwell is also the nephew of Andrew Jones. Three starts in 2013.
Yeah, he knows now his role is to give Bert Bonnev and his team some extra innings. There's Andrew Jones continuing to move around the defense.
Now look, these teams, the Netherlands included, have pretty substantial scouting reports on their opponents. They have scouts at each pool. But Andrew Jones is kind of the guy that directs the defense. He does it a lot on what he sees by the hitters, what he sees by the pitchers, the instincts that brought him 10 gold gloves in the major leagues. With some help from the scouting reports.
Well, Hensley Mullins, you see him sitting back on the bench. He has total confidence in Andrew Jones taking charge of this defense. We watched the workout prior to the opening game of this round, and Jones was in the middle of everything. He was actually in center field helping Jerickson Profar.
Right center, no one's playing there. In the gap, and Kikuchi can run. Profar has it. He'll hold at second. One reason you might not see the Japan runners try to take an extra base on a relay from the outfield is the throwing arm of Andrelton Simmons. We see that, you and I do, in the major leagues. Teams kind of shut down that extra base.
Simmons is the trail cutoff man. Scope goes out. Profar plays it off the wall. This is the first cutoff man, but there Simmons has it, and he's locked and loaded, and he's got a cannon.
So Kikuchi's got two hits. Here is Aoki. He's got two hits. This is a wild game, and it's only in the fourth. Oh! I don't know if it hit him or not. I think it went right through everything.
Certainly got his attention for sure. No matter what the intent is, it's a difficult pitch to get out of the way of, up around your neck. Your tendency is to go back and dive out of the way. Aoki was fortunate to get out of the way of that fastball. 10 runs on 13 hits so far in this game, and we're in the top of the fourth. Both of these clubs, terrific offensive teams. The Netherlands has lost their last five games to Japan, including two games here in November as a warm-up to this tournament.
Outside corner. Now remember, Rick Vandenhert wasn't getting much when he pitched to the outside corner. Markwell got that call. You wanted that call.
Another pitch inside. Remember, Aoki had an infield hit his last time up. But Xander Bogaerts dove and took an RBI away from Aoki, and Bogaerts is still shaded toward the line of third.
That's a strike. Markwell is the direct opposite of Vandenhert. Obviously, he's left-handed, but he does not throw hard, great at changing speeds, very crafty, a real different look for a Japanese lineup that was crafted for Vandenhert, the tall righty.
Yeah, and they were all set up to get on his fastball, and they did. So now they've got to throttle back and wait on the off-speed offerings of Markwell. Markwell spent seven seasons in the minor leagues with the Blue Jays.
Three, two. It's out. it's amazing that Japan has 5 runs, 8 hits, and this guy is 0 for 2 with 2 punch-outs.
Once again, it just reflects the depth of this team. They don't have to lean on one star to provide the offense. This is going to be a tough assignment for Markwell. Tsutsugo is not just a power hitter, he's a very good hitter. He had the third highest batting average last season in the Central League.
There's no way to hear if you're a pitcher and the umpire calls timeout, right? I mean, in this environment. One out. Tsutsugo, liner, Simmons has it.
Simmons really watched that ball right into his glove. It was a sinking liner right to the shortstop. Tsutsugo hit it right on the button. The base runner plays it perfectly as Kikuchi freezes on the line drive. He's able to get back safely. Markwell gets Tsutsugo, and now there's
Japan rallies. A double in the second, and in the third with two on. A 3-run homer.
And he's hit a couple of breaking balls. He hit a double in his first at bat. Hit a slider for that 3-run home run in the third inning. So they're going to give him another new look. Both those hits came off the starter, Rick Vandenberg. Chiron Martis, who has major league experience, he picked up his first big league win while pitching for the Nationals way back in 2008. Beat the Marlins in that ball game.
After the majors, he pitched in Taiwan. He's been an independent ball and a seasoned international pitcher. Comes out of the bullpen and has a tough assignment. Nakata, with 45,000 of his fan club about to serenade him.
Martis, now 29 years old, from Willemstad Kursaal. 26 games over the span of 3 seasons in the big leagues. He last pitched for Minnesota in 2013. Nakata came into this game 2 for 8, but both of his hits were home runs, and he's added a third home run here tonight. He's starting to feel it.
And Martis does not look comfortable. He's missed on all 3 pitches. As you pointed out, this is an all-star lineup, so there really is no soft spot. Maybe in the 9th spot with the catcher, Kobayashi, but he's had a good tournament.
Good fastball at 91. Kurt Blyland is probably thinking, hey, you should have thrown that on the first pitch. Get ahead. But now Nakata's seen 4 pitches and has a good gauge on everything he's dealing with in this at-bat.
It's a strike. Blylevin has some simple principles, and it really has resonated with his work with the Netherlands team. And one of those is pitch to your strength, not necessarily the hitter's weakness. Do what you do well.
Yeah.
First and second. Runners on the way, and it's fouled back to the screen.
Now got that fastball up and out over the plate and just missed it. You can see the runners retreating to their respective bases. Running on the full count with two outs.
What was it Hensley Mullins told us about Bly Levin? He's part old school with the ability to communicate with the younger player. Is strike three called. Boy, Martiz fell behind 3-0, and Nakata looks at a fastball on the outside part. And the Netherlands escapes the fourth. Tenth largest in the world. Made up of over 6,800 islands. Mount Fuji, we've had a chance to see a few times here in Tokyo. What a glorious and great place to visit. So much history, so much tradition. And in terms of baseball, what a great tradition and what a fun time if you're a baseball fan to come and watch it in a different culture, in a different environment, and at this level. There's Kurt Smith, swings and misses. Yoshihisa Hirano is the new pitcher. This place holds 45,000, and it's full.
Hirano just turned 33 years old on the 8th of March. He pitches for the Oryx Buffalo. This is his first World Baseball Classic.
Buck, if you're walking into the team store and the NPB hats are all lined up, it's a pretty good pitch that Hirano didn't get. Which cap are you going to buy? What's the team that you want to sport?
Well, the Yomiuri Giants are the number one team.
Oh,
here.
Don't be a front runner on me.
Absolutely. Well, last time we were here, Shinosuke Abe was their catcher.
That's right.
MVP.
The Johnny Bench of Japanese baseball. Okay, I'll give you that one.
Plus, I'm a San Francisco Giant fan at heart.
Well, you did grow up in Northern California, so there is that. Toshenko Ricardo. You know, I might lean towards the Carp.
Yeah.
The Hiroshima Carp.
They have Cincinnati Reds style uniforms. They have a very similar C on their cap.
The Swallows, the Colt Swallows. Although we went to Fukuoka and just had a great time. So I'm going with the SoftBank Hawks, the Fukuoka SoftBank Hawks.
Because Munenori Kawasaki played for the SoftBank Hawks forever, and he's become a very popular player in the States, beginning his career with Seattle, played in Toronto, and now he got a World Series ring with the Cubs, got some time last year with the Cubs.
One of the most enjoyable major leaguers there is. Ricardo takes down low. Watching Ricardo just for three innings, you can really see what his manager told us. Hensley Mullen said this guy is an incredible defensive catcher who is starting to figure out how to hit. He's 27. He was in the minor leagues with the Orioles, the Giants, and the Dodgers. Chase is there. And a couple outs from Hirano.
Hirano worked a 1-2-3 inning in his last appearance against China. We mentioned that he's the closer for the Oryx Buffalo, and he's got a wicked forkball. That's where he threw to Ricardo for the strikeout.
We have a translator with us who translates baseball terms, and we were both surprised and then afterwards relieved to hear that forkball in Japan is forkball.
Very easy. We won't mess that one up, Rich-san.
Fastball, now you talk about the shuto, which is a running fastball.
But I don't care where you are, when you throw a forkball like Carano, it's a forkball all over the world.
Now now those guys have been to the team stores. They're sporting all kinds of NPB love. The Chiba Lotte Marines, Yomiuri Giants. Looks like the Yokohama Bay Stars, right? And those kids brought their gloves to the Excite seats. Odeber got that rally going in the third with a one out double. And the fork ball of death from Hirano. Each Netherlands alive in the fourth. Tokyo Dome City, right in downtown Tokyo. A whale of a game, it's 5-5. And Japan goes to work in the top of the fifth. Rich Waltz, Buck Martinez, and our entire MLB crew here in Tokyo. Into left field, Sakamoto has a hit. Japan has banged out 9 hits already.
The major concern for Samurai Japan coming into this tournament was whether or not they would score any runs. And as soon as the bell rang in the opener of this series, the bats have been red hot.
I think a major concern for Netherlands right now is how do they get through this pitching wise. 3 of their main arms have already worked. Vandenhoek 3 innings, Markwell 2/3 of an inning. And here is Martiz in his second inning of work.
Team Japan scored 22 runs in 3 games in the first round. As a team, they hit 303 while holding the opponents to a 216 average. Nothing wrong with the bats.
Sakamoto's at first. Yamada's walked and singled. Runner bluffs, pitches up. I mean, think about how good this lineup is. Tetsuro Yamada stands at the plate. This is a guy that has hit 38 homers and more than 100 RBIs in his last 2 seasons and swiped over 30 bases the last 2 seasons. And he's hitting 7th. At the knees. That's a pretty good pitch to hit.
Yeah. Yamada during the regular season hits 3rd or 4th for his team. But in this situation with so many good bats, he has led off and now he's hitting down in the order tonight. Batting number 7.
Again the runner bluffs and this one gets by Ricardo. Big turn. Well, that's a an important base for Japan to get.
Ricardo doesn't do a very good job at all. That sinking fastball, he just tried to smother it with his glove. First thing you have to think about when you're getting the pitch down low near the dirt to block it, you don't want to give away 90 feet. Now they don't have that double play opportunity.
In the air, a lot of foul territory here. Kurt Smith, whoa, he overextended just a bit, but a nice correction at the end. Here's Akiyama. This is how deep this lineup is. Here they are, game 1 of round 2 after sweeping round 1. And Akiyama is in center field making his first start.
And he is the Japanese record holder for hits in a season, 216 hits for the Cebu Lions.
He's a great center fielder. No errors last year. Three-time Golden Glove winner, Cebu Lions. We really haven't heard his song, have we? Or his chant.
Hasn't had a chance to get many at bats before tonight.
Sakamoto's at second. Down the line, deep, Odubor, it's foul.
Ball carried a long way to the opposite field. Sakamoto retreats to second. Odubor going down into the corner, but it kept slicing away from him. Akiyama drove in the first run of the game with a sac fly in the second and an RBI base hit in the third. He puts the bat on the ball.
On the ground is second. That's Jonathan Scope. Sakamoto moves 90 feet to third. And now Martiz has to get Seiji Kobayashi, the catcher, to get out of the inning.
Now this is the guy you really have to be aggressive against. This is the weakest link in a very balanced lineup, the number 9 hitter. So far tonight he is 0-for-2, but he has homered in this series. But here's where Bert Blyleven's philosophy really plays itself out. Throw a strike down and away. Put the pressure on him to put the bat on the ball. Get ahead of him. Don't give him the luxury of having a hitter's count. And you throw him a breaking ball on the first pitch and you fall behind. This is a number 9 hitter in a very potent lineup. You got to be more aggressive than that. Kobayashi hit just over 200 during the regular season.
Breaking ball and a strike. It's 1-1. Now Martiz doesn't have a lot of heat. His fastball wasn't what it used to be. There was a lot of off speed. As a result, Andrelton Simmons, the shortstop, is really pulled over into the hole. It's hard to tell from that angle. And it's by Simmons into center field. Simmons was shaded towards third, and it cost him.
Because they had thrown a couple of breaking balls in the first two pitches, Simmons had moved a step to the pool side. He may have had a shot at this soft liner. Look where he's positioned at short. Ball goes up the middle. It kind of hangs up there. Simmons dives for it. Who knows, had he been more straight away, whether or not he might have caught that liner and saved a run.
So Japan takes the lead, 6-5. And here is Tanaka. Kobayashi's at first. Slow roller up the line. Smith to the bag, gets there. And Japan takes the lead, 6-5. The Netherlands over the last 8 years has really blossomed on the international scene. course, that 2009 upset twice. They took down the Dominican Republic. That got things really rolling. And then in 2013, they got to the final round of the World Baseball Classic, and they did it here in Tokyo by taking out a favored Cuba team. Now, Japan, in this tournament, dominated the first two, led by Ichiro. 2006 and 2009, they were champions. They got to the finals, that final round in 2013. And who knows, maybe they're headed back in 2017. The Tokyo Dome is full. What a fun place this has been. Not only this year, but every year when we show up to do the World Baseball Classic. Andrelton Simmons is up. And Simmons into center field. That's a base hit. That is a rude greeting for Simmons. For Kodai Senga. And Senga is one of the best weapons Japan has out of their bullpen.
We saw him in the first round. He made one appearance at two innings, gave up a hit, and struck out four. He throws hard. He'll touch 95, and he throws a hard splitter. You can see him grip that splitter in his hand as he gets set on the rubber. And his splitter will be in the low 90s.
Jurickson Profar is 1-for-2. Why has Japan cornered the market on that pitch, the splitter?
Well, I think what they do is they really work hard on their fundamentals, and we have talked about their practice routines, how they will throw over and over and over again and never settle for mediocre pitches, and I think that plays into it an awful lot.
A one.
Another thing I think that has a lot to do with their forkball success is how they repeat their delivery. And you see a lot of the Japanese pitchers gather themselves back over the rubber. Their balance point is very particular. You remember Daisuke Matsuzaka, Tanaka, Yu Darvish, they all kind of rock and gather themselves. Hideo Nomu did the same thing, where he would rock and gather himself over the rubber, and that allows them to get out in front with that forkball and really deliver the pitch very effectively. But I think it has a lot to do with how often they throw, how many times they throw the pitch on the side in their work in between. I just think they don't settle until they perfect that split finger pitch.
Now, there comes with a greater risk, some feel, of injury, and Japanese pitchers are not immune to elbow issues, and that pitch in particular can exacerbate it. You look at some of the really successful Japanese pitchers in the major leagues, and you've got guys that have had Tommy John surgery.
Most recently, Yu Darvish, of course, and Masahiro Tanaka is pitching with a elbow tear, but there's that delivery out over that front side, really drives through over that front leg and finishes up with his hand way out in front to extend.
Profar takes in the dirt.
I don't think there's any formula to keep pitchers healthy. With the introduction of the radar gun and everybody being infatuated with velocity, everybody has a tendency to throw hard. Then you have guys like Jamie Moyer and Mark Burley, Hendricks with the Cubs, Marco Estrada with the Blue Jays, just have good sound deliveries, not really trying to max out on every pitch, and have a tendency to stay healthy.
I think you said the magic word, max out. There is so much more of that in the last 10 to 15 years. Max effort, even the last 5 years. Velocity has continued to go up in Major League Baseball, and I would guess in Japanese baseball as well.
Oh, I think Senga's a great example of that. We have seen him hit 95 already in his first appearance.
Pop up, and it is out of play. Troy Murata in the early 1980s was an overworked ace for Lotte. He was the first to go to Los Angeles and meet Dr. Frank Jobe. And he underwent Tommy John surgery. Profar 1-for-2. And a great tournament so far. 7 hits. Simmons bluffs, ball in the dirt. And Senga keeps trying to tantalize with that fork ball or the split. And so far, Profar isn't biting. Now it's 3-2. Simmons is not a base stealer. You got Bogarts and Ballantyne after Profar.
Yeah, as hot as Profar is, I wouldn't be surprised if Simmons takes off. He's swinging the bat very well.
Simmons runs, and Profar fouls it at the plate.
Yeah, that's why you can send Simmons, even though he's not a base stealer, because Profar has been so consistent putting the bat on the ball. Hensley Mullins knows he's got Bogarts and Ballantyne behind Profar. And if indeed Profar should make an out, they're hopeful of getting Simmons to scoring position for the 3-4 bats in this lineup.
See if he's running again. He is. Line down the right field line. That's a fair ball. And with that head start, Simmons is racing for third. Aoki has it. And he gets it out of the corner quickly. And Profar, leaping up and down at second base, has himself a double. What a World Baseball Classic. 8 hits, 3 doubles, and a homer for Profar.
This is the kind of player Profar was before he suffered those shoulder injuries. 8 hits, running on the pitch. Cruises around second, takes a big turn around third, and they get the ball in. But Profar, you can see he's having a lot of fun here. 8 hits so far in 4 games for Profar. And you know who's also enjoying this? Jeff Banister, the manager of the Texas Rangers.
Without question. And it was Banister that Hensley Mullins called. In fact, he called every major league manager of all of these talented players for the Netherlands and went through a couple things. Here's how I'd like to use them. Is that all right with you? Is there anything about his training that you want us to continue while he's working out with us? And all of the managers, from Buck Showalter to Banister to John Farrell, they all signed off and said, go get him.
That's a natural courtesy you extend to the managers of these major league players. I did the same thing in 2006. I talked to Buck Showalter about Michael Young and Mark Teixeira. I said, you know what, we got Derek Jeter on the team. Would you mind if we played Michael Young at second a bit with Chase Utley and maybe even from time to time moving back over to third? Buck was really supportive as well.
Bogarts here has bounced out and has a sacrifice fly. Infield is back. There's nobody out. And the Netherlands, against one of the better weapons Japan has out of their bullpen, threatening here to tie it and to take the lead. And now that forkball really becomes a weapon. Why has it gone away in Major League Baseball? I mean, it's not completely gone, but it certainly has diminished.
Well, I think it's gone away partly because of the same reason the curveball has gone away, is we're not patient enough to allow the pitchers to learn how to throw it consistently. Like everything else in our society, we want instant results.
With a word for the home plate umpire, but that looked like it was a strike. This copyrighted telecast presented by the Authority, the World Baseball Classic Incorporated, may not be reproduced, retransmitted in any form. The accounts and descriptions of the game may not be disseminated without the express written consents. So that's a big strikeout, but still, Japan has to deal with Ballantyne, who hit a two-run homer his last time up. Infield is in with runners second and third. In case you missed it, don't blink, because it's out in a hurry.
Third inning with a man aboard. Vladimir Ballantyne ties it up with one swing of the bat. That was his first extra base hit of this tournament.
Low fastball. Ballantyne fouls it back. So the strikeout of Bogarts now. And Senga is 0-2 on Ballantyne. Gregorius is up, and you got a pair of Dutch runners out there. Not to be confused with Dutch Rennert. Andrelton Simmons and Jurickson Profar. O-2. Up in. Ballantyne looking out at Senga, and he first glared at Kobayashi.
Well, Senga and Ballantyne, they know each other. They both play here, and Senga pitches for the SoftBank Hawks. Ballantyne plays for the Colt. So they have faced each other in the past.
That inside fastball is something that you see in Japan. You talked about it, the shuto. And the shuto sets up a gorgeous breaking ball.
They get Bogarts on a called third strike. This is the splitter, and watch the bottom fall out. After that up and in fastball, difficult to hang in there on that splitter down and away. Senga's got a big arm and a wicked out pitch.
So if anything is going to come of this inning, Didi Gregorius is going to have to make it happen, or at least get on base with Scope on deck. And this is not an easy ride for Kobayashi. Senga continues to pound splitters into the dirt.
Kobayashi's terrific behind the plate. Very agile, and he moves around very well. And for a pitcher that throws that splitter so hard, that's a tremendous amount of confidence, knowing that that catcher is going to block your best pitch in the dirt.
Gregorius. Nakata, and Japan escapes. Senga. Japan has a one-run lead. Sho Nakata's three-run homer big for Japan. Jonathan Scope and Vladimir Ballantyne both with home runs for the Netherlands. So a one-run game. Chiron Martiz still out there for the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Bouncer up the middle. That is Andrelton Simmons, and that's routine in his world. Going to his left to get Kikuchi for the first out of the sixth inning.
Excuse me, Rich. It's really interesting about watching Simmons play. You made a point of saying he's not really a fast base runner. He's not a base stealing threat. Well, boy, you talk about covering a lot of ground. He has terrific range because he's got knowledge of the hitters, and he has exceptional anticipation. He's watching the flight of the ball, anticipating where the ball might be hit, and that allows him to cover so much ground. And when you really think about shortstops around the major leagues, how many of the shortstops that are so good do you really consider to be fast? Troy Tulowitzki, J.J. Hardy. You just think of those shortstops around baseball, even Brandon Crawford. You wouldn't call him a real burner, but they have so good instincts. And reading the ball off the bat, that's how they're able to cover so much ground.
American League Gold Glove finalist last year. That one's foul. Francisco Lindor of Cleveland, Simmons, Jose Iglesias of Detroit.
Iglesias is not what you would call a fast runner, but their first step is a very quick one. They cover a lot of ground. Well, just think about Cal Ripken, how many years he played so well at shortstop. He wasn't fast, but boy, did he have the instincts. Troy Tulowitzki is the same with the Blue Jays.
He's been banged up a little bit, and he was injured last year. I think that may be one of the reasons he did not win the Gold Glove. He played just 130 games, Simmons. Aoki walks, and that brings up Setsugo. And he's going to get a look at Martis. All right, who's the most feared slugger on this side of the bracket in the World Baseball Classic? Is it Yoshitomo Setsugo? Is it Alfredo Despain?
Sho Nakata's making a bid for that title for sure. He's hit three home runs now, including a three-run homer in this game.
It's a great call.
But Setsugo still has the lead in the chant department.
You know, I know Despaña has played here in Japan. I'd love to hear his chant from his home ballpark.
They wouldn't dare give him his chant while he's wearing a Cuba uniform.
No. And by the way, what a costly loss for Cuba to Israel today. Israel beating Cuba, in case you missed that score. That was our first game of the day here. That was a 4-1 Israel win. Now Cuba is 0-1. And in the same pool here, the same round as Japan and the Netherlands. So Cuba sits at 0-1. Each team plays three games. And Israel is 1-0. Cuba plays Japan next on Tuesday night. Israel has this Netherlands team tomorrow night. And the wild, amazing, impossible ride that Israel has had to go 4-0. And sit 1-0 here in the second round. It's very possible that Israel is just one win away from advancing to Los Angeles.
Yeah, they got off to a great start. Israel's playing with a lot of confidence. They'll send Corey Baker to the mound against the Netherlands, who will call upon Jair Gurgens in that second game. That'll take place tomorrow night.
Setsugo with one out here. Aoki the run. And he popped it up. Simmons ventures out and makes the catch.
Martis now, with two outs, will face the first man he faced when he entered the game in the fourth inning, Sho Nakata, and he struck him out looking on a fastball down and away.
A double, a three-run homer, two runs scored. Nakata. Now his swing, Buck, when we were here in 2013 and you saw Japan up close in 06 and 09, it seems to me that the swings have started to change. That's the way it has sounded to us as well. 6-5, Japan on top. Jonathan Scope, who homered early in the game, lines one in the gap, right center field. Aoki is there, and he runs it down.
Rich, you made a point earlier in the ballgame how deep Aoki is playing in right field, and that's his natural position. Although he's going to play left field for Houston in the upcoming season, he's played most of his games in the major leagues in right field. He was deep in that situation, and rightly so. You don't want to give up a double to the leadoff man, so he was able to run down that ball in the alley in right center.
There is Kurt Smith. Now, the Netherlands has a slew of talented major league infielders, marquee names. But this guy has done some hitting in international play, and that's in the gap, and Kurt Smith is on his way to second, and he's in there. Buck Martinez to win tournaments, to get as far as they've been able to get in the World Baseball Classic. It takes more than a team of major league shortstops. And Kurt Smith is one of those unsung heroes on this team. Dashenko Ricardo is, Odubor is, Kalean Sams as well. All those guys have had big hits in international competition.
Well, and we saw the same type of production from some of the role players on the Israeli team earlier today. Blake Galen, Scott Burcham, they both had big tournaments so far, and they've helped contribute to that 4-0 start for Israel.
Here's Ricardo, his second World Baseball Classic. I mean, think about the two big swings in WBC history for the Netherlands. It was Yarendel de Caster that hit the liner off of Willy Ibar when the Netherlands dropped the Dominicans. And it was Kalean Sams who here had the walk-off sacrifice fly to beat Cuba and send the Netherlands to the World Baseball Classic final round.
Sams is on this team, but he has yet to get an at bat for the Netherlands. They're missing one of the players they had in 2013 in Roger Bernardina, who is playing in Korea.
Korea has not been real cooperative when it comes to letting Dutch players who are signed to play in Korea play in this event. Remember, they were the ones that held Rick Vandenhoek out in 13, and they would not allow Bernardina to play here in 17. No coincidence, Netherlands open play in Korea.
Korea was eliminated along with Chinese Taipei in Seoul in Pool A in the first round.
See, that should have earned them the right to free Roger Bernardina. Here's a 2-1. Off the end of the bat, little number, and Senga thought about Kurt Smith, who got a early start, then stopped, and then started, and instead Senga gets the out at first, and it's up to Odubor to get this thing tied up.
Odubor 1-for-2 so far in this ball game, had a double down the right field line his first time up.
The Groovin' Aruban. Odubor 6 years in the Nationals organization.
Senga's got a good fastball.
And it's that pitch that Hensley Mullins told us that when he came from the major leagues to play in Japan, that's the pitch he had to learn how to hit. And he taught himself how to hit it, and he said he's been able to, with the San Francisco Giants hitters, really get on them to try to hit that inside fastball. Brandon Crawford is one of the guys that he thinks he's had the most success with. And, you know, it's amazing to hear him say that Buster Posey is still learning how to do that. It stuns me to find out that Buster Posey is still learning how to do anything as good as he is.
Well, I think what Mullins is talking about is to realize his full potential.
Yeah, and well, that's scary.
He thinks he still has room to grow.
That's scary. As good as he is. Here's the 2-0 pitch. to Oduber. To strike.
Brandon Crawford, fine shortstop of the Giants with back-to-back 84 RBI seasons for San Francisco. Ends the Nealands, their hitting coach.
Oduber now will get a 2-1 pitch. Kurt Smith at third base. Now that splitter comes into play.
Well, it comes into play for Kurt Smith at third base as well. You've got to be anticipating a ball in the dirt, maybe a short pass ball, wild pitch gets away from Kobayashi.
Two, two. There's the splitter. And another strikeout for Senga. And Japan holds on to a slim lead. Here of the second round on this side of the world and this side of the bracket in the World Baseball Classic. Valentin runs it down in right field. Sakamoto's out number one. Game summary here. It started with a bang. Shonakata, this is a three-run homer. But the Netherlands, down 5-1, rallied, and this Vladimir Valentin home run tied it at 5. And then Japan, with their catcher, a broken bat, dumps it into center. That's how we've arrived at 6-5. With all the singing and the chanting. Just a terrific ball game, a playoff atmosphere. And that's what you get in the second round.
Rich, you know me, and no one's more old school than I am, but I'm starting to understand how you create interest among the young fans. You accept bat flips. You accept demonstrative reactions. You let the players have those personalities. That's what these fans want to see. And I think we have to allow that to come into the major leagues. The excitement of a fist pump after a strikeout, of a bat flip by Valentin when he hits the foul pole. I think we have to turn the page and say, you know what? If we're going to attract the young fan and bring him back into this game, we're going to have to let the Bryce Harpers and the Mike Trouts and the Marcus Stroman show their emotion. This is what people like to see, a little flair in the game. It's all over in the NBA, in the NFL, in the NHL. Baseball has been late to the party in that regard.
Buck Martinez, preach. Preach, brother.
Well, I just think that when you're trying to create this type of atmosphere, the Jose Bautista bat flip in the playoffs.
One of the great moments.
Iconic across Canada.
Yes, I agree.
And you just have to allow players to have that type of personality. When Cruz hit the home run for the Dominican Republic, the team ran onto the field. Of course, when I started in 1969, that would have led to beanball after beanball, but it's a different time.
Jeron Martínez misses up. Now, I think the other way is to bottle what these people have been consuming and bring it over to Major League Baseball. This is just an incredible scene, night after night, when Japan plays. Now, I know this is their all-star team, and this is an enormous event here in Japan, but this is like a giant party, and we've said it. I forget the writer's name who said college football or college basketball, European soccer, and Mad Max all in one.
And the age spread. I mean, we've seen 8-9-year-old kids here having a blast. And who'll forget the youngster with the Australian teams with their noisemakers
yes.
and screaming and acknowledging the home run by James Beresford when he hit the grand slam. That's what people want to see, this kind of reaction. It's entertainment. Let the players show their personalities and the fans will follow suit.
Michael Bauman was the author of that article with a great analogy of watching these Japanese crowds in the ringer. Martis now is at 45 pitches. He gets to 50, 4 days rest. That means he's done for this round.
And the Netherlands doesn't have the depth that Japan has in their bullpen.
But it's a one-run game, and so what do you do here if you're Hensley Mullins? Bert Blyleven has a man warm, and that one is flipped into the seats. Buck, you've managed in this event.
Same in the fucking before, but like
this. Yeah, this is a real challenge for this event, especially for the Netherlands, who don't have the real deep pen. You throw 50 pitches, you're done.
One-two pitch. Did he go? Runner goes. It wasn't a called strike, and it wasn't a swing.
Ricardo couldn't find the handle on the baseball. Pitch was inside. He double clutched, and by the time he grabbed it, Nakayama has another stolen base. Third of the night for Team Japan.
Two outs. Kobayashi fouls it back to the screen.
Kobayashi's going to want to go in and renegotiate his contract after the way he's been swinging the bat.
And here comes Mullins after 49 pitches. So there's your answer. They want Martis in games 2 and 3. They can't have him if he throws another pitch.
They can't afford to lose him. He's been effective keeping the Netherlands within striking distance, and the Netherlands plays again tomorrow and then again on Wednesday.
To the bullpen goes the Netherlands. Netherlands has maybe the tallest pitching staff in captivity. This is Mike Bolsenbroek, 6'8", 210 pounds, 29-year-old, born in the Netherlands. They also have Luc Van Meel, who's the tallest professional pitcher ever at 7'1". So just in case they get a call tomorrow from the NCAA selection committee, the Netherlands is ready.
2-2 count on the batter, Kobayashi.
Just outside.
Kobayashi with another RBI base hit in this game. He's driven in 4 for the tournament, batting in the 9th spot.
Don't know what the Netherlands RPI is right now, though. Not sure what Ken Palm has him at. Here's a 3-2. Got him. Fastball up and in. Oh, that's nice stuff from Bolsenbroek, who comes in for Martis. It's still a one-run game. A winner-take-all game against Cuba. Cuba was up 8-6, bottom 8, Andrelton Simmons tied it at 8, and that set up the dramatic walk-off.
They beat Cuba twice in that series, and that enabled them to go to the next round. And you know, when you look at the new pitcher, lefty Yuki Matsui. And he's a reliever that's pitched in this tournament.
And just to correct myself, that home run was actually against Japan. He hit almost the same pitch, the same distance, to tie Cuba. We'll show you that one in a few days.
This is Matsui appearing for the second time in this tournament. The lefty, as Senga, threw 30 pitches, but Japan has an off day tomorrow, and that's all Senga needs, one day of rest, and he is eligible to pitch again on Tuesday.
Simmons goes after a high fastball. Nakata climbs the rail, makes a reach, and doesn't get it. A couple things here. There's a wall there that hides or shelters the photographers. And the other thing, there's no warning track here at the Tokyo Dome in foul territory, which players, especially third baseman, first baseman, will tell you is just as important as having one in the outfield.
Yeah, especially for players playing in this ballpark for the first time. Not really sure how much room you have in foul territory. It'd be nice to have a warning track to give you some idea where you are.
Simmons fouls that back. That's 0-2. Now those are the excite seats that are exposed. You see the fence, or actually it's a screen, which rings from home plate all the way down the line, and the excite seats are exposed. But you got your helmet and you got your glove waiting for you in the seat.
And yes, they leave them there for the next game.
That's just as impressive as the fact that they're there to begin with. Here's the 0-2. Strike three called. Simmons shaking his head, yes.
Matsui's got a good fastball. He's not very big, but he can bring it. Good fastball, and watch the reaction of Simmons. Right down the middle, about knee high, and he knew it. Just couldn't pull the trigger on that fastball. Simmons with two hits so far in this game, caught looking at strike three.
That's a rarity that Simmons on a fastball gets caught looking. He's not a guy that strikes out much. He's not a guy that walks a whole lot. And he has a real affinity for fastballs. Profar now, the switch hitter, flips over for the first time from this side of the plate. On the other side of the plate, he's 2-for-3. He's only 8-for-14 so far in the four games in the WBC.
Yeah, he's finally healthy, and that is such good news for Profar and for the Texas Rangers. They've been counting on him for a while, but that shoulder problem had lingered, and he just couldn't get healthy enough to play. And now he's playing center field here for the Netherlands.
That's out. Even Profar telling the catcher, hey, that's out. Now you've got Profar at the plate. You've got Kobayashi behind it, and then you've got a Dominican umpire. I know baseball is the universal language. Here's a 2-1.
Well, most of these players on Team Netherlands speak 4 or 5 languages.
Yes, they do.
I don't know how up on their Japanese they are, but they can certainly speak Spanish, Papiamento native language, and Dutch. And it's really interesting standing around the batting cage during batting practice. You hear all kinds of languages from them. They switch from one to another very fluidly.
Israel today stunned Cuba. Sooner or later, I guess we have to stop using words like stunned. I think it still holds for Israel. They swept through all three games in Korea, and they won their first here, amazingly, in Japan. And you've got Japan and Netherlands, their first game of round 2. Chopper towards third. It is a foul ball. Profar beats it, but the home plate umpire has the call. If the ball is fielded before it gets to third, it's the home plate umpire's call. And Profar thinks it's a hit. He's taking off his gear at first base. Watch where the ball is fielded, just in front of the bag. And the home plate umpire made the call immediately.
Tanaka, ball takes him into foul territory. The home plate umpire, Felix Tejada, made the call. And he was very emphatic about calling it foul. But Profar had taken off his shin guard and now walks slowly back to home plate.
And here comes Hensley Mullins. Now, remember, there's no replay as we know it in Major League Baseball now. When the four teams get to Los Angeles, there will be full-blown replay, and Mullins is on his way back.
But you can't ask for replay on fair or foul until it gets past the umpires down the lines.
You are right about that.
So even if there were Major League replay in place, you couldn't ask for a review of that call.
Would you like to see that added to the replay menu, like an a la carte addition?
Yeah, I think that would be one they should include.
3-2. It's a nice at bat by Profar.
A real good at bat and a string of good at bats for Profar as he gets on base with a one out walk, and now you've got Bogarts coming to the plate.
Well, this was a key point in the lineup in the fifth inning for Kodai Senga. Down a run, the Netherlands got a single from Andrelton Simmons. Profar doubled. And you had Bogarts, Ballantyne, and Gregorius coming up. You thought for sure that they would tie the game. But Senga struck out Bogarts. He struck out Ballantyne, and Gregorius bounced out. Now Profar has a stolen base. That was back in Korea.
Bogarts didn't like that call. You could see his reaction. Thought it was down and in, but it's called the strike. He backs up from it and can't believe a home plate umpire called it strike one. Bogarts finished the regular season with 192 hits for the Red Sox.
That's out as well.
You think about Mookie Betts with 214, Dustin Pedroia with 201, and then Bogarts 192 hits. The Red Sox have a stacked lineup, even with the loss of David Ortiz.
There you go, a little Red Sox, a little Marlins representation here in Japan. No swing. That's Larry Vanover down at first. Of course, the Marlins logo you see in and around Tokyo because of Ichiro's presence and the great accomplishment last year of his 3,000 hits. The Red Sox, and we talked about Craig Shipley and John Diebel and all of the great talent they were able to get out of Japan onto that Red Sox roster that helped propel them to some world championships. 2-1.
Koji Uehara and Junichi Tozawa, mainstays in the Red Sox bullpen.
Well, you got Ballantyn and that ferocious right-handed bat. And a right-hander is ready in Japan's pen.
Miyanishi, the lefty. Hiroki Kokubo, the 45-year-old manager, dedicated to Samurai Japan, signed after the 13 tournament.
Drops in for a strike. Bogarts has had a discussion with Tejada a couple times. Here's a look.
Well, that breaking ball looked like it went around the plate.
So the count's full. Let's see if Profar is running. Bottom seven, Netherlands down a run.
Full count, one out. Look how deep the outfielders are for Japan. I mean, they are backed up. Bogarts, he loops one over the infielder's head. Profar can coast over to third and might be able to score if he drops it in the right spot.
See if he's running here. Matsui ready. Not running. Up the middle. Diving stop. Kikuchi Sakamoto for the out. Wow.
Ryosuke Kikuchi committed just four errors in 141 games last season. And he's a wizard with the glove right between the pitcher's legs. Somewhat of a distraction for the second baseman, but he flips it with his glove to Sakamoto. A much appreciated defensive play behind Matsui, the pitcher.
That's a terrific play in a tight game. The Hiroshima Carp. We've seen this before.
Great range at second base, and we mentioned he committed just four errors all season long during the regular season. Another glove flip on the short hop from Kikuchi. A special player with great range, good hands at second base, and he takes a hit away from Bogarts and turns it into a force out.
Ryo Akiyoshi is a teammate of Vladimir Ballantyn's. And it's Ballantyn who stands in.
Akiyoshi gave up a two-run double in his first appearance to Yurisbel Gracial in the game against Cuba.
Pitches out.
He would chase. Akiyoshi had a good inning of work in the ninth inning against China, retired the side in order. Different caliber hitter he's dealing with Ballantyn.
Ballantyn's homer was a dart halfway up the foul pole and left. A two-run homer. It tied the game at five. And he has another one down the left field line, and it's just foul into the corner, and it would have tied the game. With two outs, Bogarts was off on contact.
So we'll regroup again. 2-1 count on Ballantyn. Everything has been soft, and everything has been away. Akiyoshi, that sidearm delivery. Ballantyn out in front just a bit. It's a little too much hook on it, and it hooks foul down into the left field corner. I tell you again, the outfit for Japan, I mean, they couldn't get any deeper without buying a ticket. They are just steps off the warning track in the outfield. A lot of room for a base hit to drop. Akiyoshi got away with one right there. Fastball inside. A little sheepish smile from Ballantyne. Well, you got to think he's going to go back away now with that frisbee slider.
Andrew Jones watching. That's who Ballantyne grew up idolizing. His teammate, and a light moment there, but a big strikeout for Japan. Ryo Akiyoshi strikes out Vladimir Ballantyne. Japan still by a run. Big strikeouts coming from Team Japan. Tom DeBlock comes in for the Netherlands, and he becomes the fourth man out of the bullpen for Hensley Mullins.
Tom DeBlock just 20 years old. He signed a minor league deal with the Mariners in August of 2013 as a 17-year-old. He's on in this one-run game to start the eighth. Pretty good fastball.
Tanaka in the leadoff spot is 0 for 4, but the damage for Japan is further down in the lineup. Kikuchi, who's on deck, has 2 hits. Aoki in the 3 spot, 2 hits. Nakata, a 3-run homer and a double. He's in the 5 position. And the 6, 7, 8, and 9 spots all have hits for Japan.
Now you could bet that Bert Blyleven is very pleased to be able to put a 20-year-old into this ball game that has that kind of velocity. DeBlock had a 1-2-3 inning of work in the first round. Faced a minimum 3 batters, had a strikeout.
DeBlock trying to pick on that inside corner. Count 3-2. Down the line, Odeber is there.
Odeber was shaded toward the foul line given the velocity of the block, and that ball was slicing. It was a fair ball when he caught it. Good job by Odeber shading the hitter the opposite direction.
Here is Kikuchi now. He's 2 for 4. A terrific defensive play to help keep this game 6-5.
What a defensive play Kikuchi made, taking a hit away from Xander Bogaerts in the 7th. Base hit headed into center field. He backhanded it and flipped it with his glove for the force out at 2nd.
That's a strike. It's 2-1. 45,000 here, and they have been up and going even before first pitch. It's a block throwing a free and easy at 93. That's Bogaerts. Oh, he's out. I thought he was safe. No instant replay until everybody gets to Dodger Stadium. Here's a look.
Well, Kikuchi thought he was safe too. Bogarts with a strong arm, but he took a little time in unloading it, and that one might be overturned once they get to LA and implement full replay. Kikuchi's reaction suggests he thought he beat it out.
Now Aoki, who's been on base all four times, a real catalyst. He's walked twice, singled and scored, and doubled.
Tom, the block, throwing quality pitches. That's a nasty slider. Really fooled Aoki. He's 20 years old. And watch this hard breaking ball disappear on Aoki.
Did he go? Yes, he did. Trevor Grieve says a swing, and Tom DeBlock goes 1-2-3 through Japan in the eighth. Netherlands, Naoki Miyanishi, little lefty, comes in, kind of a lefty specialist. A 1.52 ERA. Japan has a lot of different looks that they can bring out of their pen.
Miyanishi, just his second appearance, he worked an inning and racked up two strikeouts. Brought in to face D.D. Gregorius to start the bottom of the eighth.
And Gregorius takes outside. Jonathan Scope and Kurt Smith also do up. But Japan's bullpen is deep and talented, as deep as you'll find on this side of the bracket.
Gregorius hit .324 last season against left-handed pitchers. But he's facing a lefty he's not seen before. And that's a big sweeping breaking ball. But Gregorius, in fact, hit four of his 20 home runs against lefty pitching.
Gregorius bloops this into right center. It's going to fall for a hit. Big turn, and he'll stop there.
Now, there's the problem with playing so deep. Gregorius popped it up, dropped it in front of the center fielder out of no man's land, and a leadoff base hit here in the eighth inning. Look how deep the outfielders are. They've got a long run to try to make a play on it. In fact, Kikuchi, the second baseman, was the closest defender when this ball hit the turf. Good effort by Gregorius, just in case there was a bottle in the outfield.
Well, they're deep again for Scope, who homered to left, has flied to center, and then lined out to left. So he's had some good at-bats. Not to the extent of Profar, but Scope has had some injury issues. 2013, missed a couple months with a back injury. 2015, 3 months with a knee. His older brother is on the team as well, Sharlin Scope. He was on that 2009 team as well. Sharlin was. That one is rifled into left and a hit. And the Netherlands has Gregorius and Scope on with base hits. It's the bottom third of the order coming up now. Kurt Smith.
First and second, nobody out. Bottom of the eighth inning. This lineup now with 10 hits. They have matched Team Japan 10 hits apiece, but Japan has a 6-5 lead. Interesting now as the infield is coming to the mound, talking about the possibility of a bunt and how they might defend it. Mullen's going to deliver the message personally to his hitter, Kurt Smith.
In Korea, Mullen's thought Smith was thinking too much at the plate. He let a lot of fastballs get by him, and Mullen's told us that's not Kurt Smith. He's a guy that usually jumps on those pitches. In fact, he took him out of the lineup in game three, but he's back in tonight.
He was 0-for-7 in the first two games and took a lot of hittable pitches. So the skipper sat him out, had a chat with him, said, hey, man, you're too good a hitter to be thinking that much. Turn it loose. He had a double in the alley in left center his last time up.
So much of when you bunt is what you've got coming up afterwards. And that's Dashenko Ricardo, the number 8 hitter, the catcher. And Smith does square. And I think Japan, maybe in a little bit of doubt, spins toward second to see if he held his ground.
Well, he squared awfully early. And now Japan's going to put on another bunt defense as the catcher Kobayashi out in front of home plate to give the infield the signs, and Sakamoto and Kikuchi up the middle are talking about their responsibilities here.
He is squaring, infield's charging, and he takes in for ball one. Now Smith is a guy that has some pop. He lined to the warning track in the second. He doubled in the sixth. Pair of righties in Japan's bullpen.
Makita is the submariner with a wicked sinker. He was on the left of your screen.
The catcher Ricardo is due up next. Then you've got Randolph Odeberg, who has doubled and struck out twice. He's the number 9 hitter. That's before you get to Simmons, Profar, and Bogarts. Nakata charging at first. And I'll tell you what, Kurt Smith does not look comfortable bunting at all. He really stabbed at that ball.
Yeah, he sure did. And it's going to be very difficult for him to get down a good sack bunt. Show Nakata, the first baseman, I mean, he's more than halfway toward home by the time the ball is in the hitting zone. Nakata really crashing hard from first. Tanaka at third is hanging out near the bag. Again, another sign. And the catcher Kobayashi reminding the infielders, hey, be alert for that slash bunt, square around early and swing at it.
Now Nakata is really, as you can see, tight at first. No sign of bunt here. Takes it out. Now Kobayashi really framed it and tried to hold it for Felix Tejada.
Big sweeping breaking ball, but it goes around the outside corner. We mentioned how many big hits Kurt Smith has had for this team in international play. Got a great opportunity here in the eighth.
Well, out in front of that breaking ball. Miyanishi got good speed out there. Gregorius at second, Scope at first. Netherlands down a run, bottom 8. 2-2 to Smith. Got him with a fastball. That's an enormous out.
Fastball up and away. Might have been off the plate outside, but I think Hensley Mullins, after he saw Kurt Smith square around and punch at that bunt attempt in the first pitch, changed his mind. Said he didn't look very comfortable. I might be better off to let him swing.
Now you've got Ricardo, the catcher, who's 0-for-3. And no offense, Buck, But when you mention catcher with runners on and one out, everyone, including middle infielders, start to think double play.
Absolutely they do. And you see how the defense is back. And this is another reason why I don't like the slide rule at second.
Well, the slide rule is in effect because these are major league rules.
Right. But the reason Nakata can play so far behind the runner at first is he doesn't have to worry about that runner taking out the middle infield on a double play. So that allows him more range defensively. So these two middle infielders not concerned about a hard slide at second. They can hang in there all they want.
The 1-0 pitch.
I think the slide rule really changes the game for that reason. You allow the first baseman to play way behind the runner. He doesn't have to cut his lead down, which gives the defense more range on the infield. And now the middle infielders will just hang out around the bag. You played middle infield, you understand. When you know that guy's bearing down on you from first, it's going to be a little tougher to turn a double play.
It has certainly changed the dynamics of, I think, what scouts look for in a guy who can turn the double play as well. I mean, you used to have to make sure that your middle infielders were able to get out of the way, were fleet of foot, nifty enough around the bag not to expose themselves. Now you can fudge a little bit. If you have a second baseman that's maybe not as quick or not as nifty, you can live with that.
Yeah, I just don't agree with the rule either at second or at home. Thinking you're taking a very exciting play out of the game.
Here's the 1-2. It's out.
I can speak from experience. I suffered a broken ankle in a collision at home plate because I was blocking the plate to save a run.
Yeah, but you got two outs on that play. I mean, I've seen the highlights.
But I tell you, I wouldn't have played 17 years if I wasn't able to block the plate.
That's true. YouTube it. Buck Martinez, broken leg, blocks plate. It's amazing. Here, counts 2-2. First and second. One out. Netherlands down a run, bottom eight. That's way out, and it's 3-2. All of a sudden, Mianishi can't throw that breaking ball for a strike. And you got Ricardo with a full count, and the bullpen's ready to go with two righties. The number nine hitter, Randolph Odeberg, is on deck.
The pitching coach over the shoulder of Kokobo, the manager. Hiroshi Gando, 78 years old, lots of experience.
Runners on the move, and it's outside. How about that? With one out, the runners were moving, and again, Mianishi misses outside. And I think Kokubo has seen enough, and Gando is on his way out. You really double team it here from the bench, right? The pitching coach and the manager come out. The manager comes out to make the change. The pitching coach.
The pitching coach will go to the mound and take the baseball from the pitcher. Gando, a longtime pitching coach and manager, managed the Yokohama Bay Stars, and he's 78 years old and has the ultimate respect of his pitchers.
Tension grows even more now. One run game, bags loaded in the eighth. The Netherlands and Japan playing their first game of the second round. Some big home runs, great defense, big strikeouts. And now bottom eight here, Hiroshi Matsui is the sixth reliever for Japan. He's got the number nine hitter, Randolph Odeberg, who has doubled and struck out twice. You've got Andrelton Simmons and Jurickson Profar waiting to get their cuts as well. Infield back for two. And the first pitch is ball one.
Hensley Mullins, the manager for Netherlands, really anxious to turn this lineup over, get back to Simmons, Profar, and Bogarts. Of course, Team Japan thinking about a double play to keep them on deck. Don't want to see them in this situation for sure if you're Japan.
Odeberg trying to shoot one through the right side. And the count evens at 1-1. The inning opened with Gregorius and Scope singling. A strikeout of Smith and a walk to Ricardo. The second pitcher of the inning, the right-hander, Masui. He brings it at 93.
Odeberg doubled just inside the bag at first base back in the third inning, and then he is struck out in his next two at bats. A strikeout might be better than contact here.
One, two. No contact. A strikeout. Two outs, bags still loaded, and here comes Andrelton Simmons.
Well, at least you get Simmons to the plate in this situation, down by a run. Odeberg strikes out for the third time. But Simmons has had a good night at the plate. A couple of singles and an RBI. He's scored a run.
For
and
some
you
of the
can bet he's looking first pitch fastball.
Buck, for some of the players that play internationally, and I think we saw this with Cuba, mid-90s gives them trouble. But you've got a guy at the plate who obviously plays in the major leagues, and major league bullpens live mid-90s and north of that. So Simmons, Profar, Bogarts, all those guys are used to seeing this type of velocity.
And this is exactly why Simmons is in the top of this batting order. Mullins has tremendous respect for his ability to come through in a clutch.
1-0 pitch. In the dirt. Now Simmons is certainly not the most selective hitter. He's known for early action in his at bats. He puts the ball in play a lot. He doesn't strike out. He doesn't walk much.
He's really got a keyhole here with the count in his favor. They've thrown him a couple of splits, not close. This catcher Kobayashi, he's tremendous on those balls in the dirt.
Two down, bags loaded, 2-0 coming to Andrelton Simmons. It hit his arm, I believe, and the game, did it get him or did it get the bat? Simmons reached for his elbow and it hit the bat.
Wow.
What a break for Japan.
Fastball inside, a check swing. Does it hit the bat? Indeed.
Yes.
It does, right off the barrel of the bat for a strike.
That's a huge break. So instead of 3-0, it's 2-1. And Simmons gets a timeout and steps out.
Simmons trying to clear his head. Is he going to throw me another splitter in the dirt?
He's 2-for-4 with an RBI single. Bases loaded. 2-1. Fastball, ground ball up the middle. Sakamoto to Kikuchi. And Japan gets out of it again. The Dutch leave them loaded. And Japan is still hanging on by a run. And that last out. Now, Buck Martinez, you made a plea for celebrating, and each nation does it in their own way. Watch the dugout from Japan.
They got the force out, stranded the bases loaded, and kept the one-run lead as we go to the ninth.
And nearly emptied the dugout.
Absolutely.
Tsutsugo. Tsutsugo is a pretty big guy. I mean, he's built. Now, this is a really big guy. This is Luke Van Meel, 32 years old, 7-1, 260. The Dutch closer in the ninth in a one-run game, and he's gone 3-0 on a dangerous hitter. Got the big bats coming up here for Japan. 92 on the fastball from Van Meel.
Van Meel made four relief appearances in 2013, picked up a win.
That is a bullet out to Scope, who's in shallow right, and he gets the out.
Well, Jonathan Scope playing the big pull hitter out in the outfield, as he would in the American League East, facing those big left-handed power hitters, and he was out there in shallow right to make an easy play. What a ball game. Each team with 10 hits.
Now Nakata, the hitting hero tonight for Japan. A double, a three-run homer. To right, Ballantyne makes the catch. Keep in mind that when this game gets to the bottom of the ninth, the Netherlands will have Jurickson Profar, Xander Bogaerts, Vladimir Ballantyne, Didi Gregorius, and in the five spot will be Jonathan Scope. That's all you can ask for if you're Hensley Mullins.
Got to keep it a one-run game.
Sakamoto. What does 7 foot one do for a hitter?
It's intimidating to begin with. By the time he hits his full stride, he gains about 7 or 8 feet toward home plate.
Sakamoto lines it left field. And Hayato Sakamoto continues a nice tournament. He's 2 for 3 tonight.
Been on base 3 times with a walk. He scored a couple of runs. But by the time Van Meel takes his stride down the mound, he reaches out and releases that ball. It gets on it in a hurry.
Here is Yamada. Who in any lineup in any country has no business hitting in the 7th spot. I mean, really, I mean, this. Attendance is just under 45,000.
Nice play by Ricardo on that hard slider in the dirt. With 2 outs, don't want to give up an extra 90 feet. Van Meel, from what I remember, he's got better stuff this year than we saw in the past. Picked up a little velocity.
Oh, nasty, just nasty. And Yamada doesn't like the thrust into the role of closer. Takahiro Norimoto is a starter, and many thought would be a starter in the World Baseball Classic, but here he is in the ninth against the best that the Netherlands has. Profar, the hitting star so far in this WBC, is 8 for 14, 3 doubles, a homer, 3 RBIs. And he has a rip at a fastball at 94 miles an hour.
Norimoto is a strikeout pitcher. He's led the Pacific League in strikeouts for 3 consecutive seasons. Over 200 strikeouts each year. Pitches for the Rakuten Golden Eagles. On the corner. There's that split at 87.
Suzuki now in right, and Aoki replaces Tsutsugo in left. So defensive change by Japan, and a very speedy and very good outfield now. Three pitches in is Norimoto. Outside corner. Kofar doesn't like it, but it looked like a pretty good pitch.
Bogarts protects Profar. Fastball knee high on the outside corner. Profar didn't like the call, thought it was off the plate away, and expresses that to the home plate umpire. Profar's had a great series. Can't believe he was called out. Now Bogarts.
Bogarts hitless, has a sacrifice fly. 95 with that fastball. And of course, you got Ballantyne, who holds the all-time record for home runs in a season in Japan, and his homered tonight is on deck. There's a wrinkle, and it misses. There is Ballantyne.
Slider hard down and away, 3-1.
Round two, opening day. Israel, yes, Israel again with a big win today. They took down Cuba. And here a nail biter in the bottom of the ninth. Japan a one-run lead and a breaking ball. And Bogarts had a pitch to hit there. That one just backed up right over the plate.
Yeah, but it's hard to sit on that breaking ball, 3-1, but he was able to drop it in for a strikeout. This guy's got big league stuff.
3-2. Down low, fastball. And Bogarts is aboard, and the Netherlands has life. And now, if Ballantyne gets a hold of one, he could end the game. And the crowd knows it. They know Ballantyne. They know he hit 60 home runs in a season in 2013, breaking the record held by Sadahara Oh. A two-run homer in the third, has struck out his last two times up. See if he gets the heater. Breaking ball catches a corner. A fastball.
I tell you what, Norimoto has gotten the attention of the scouts behind home plate. We've seen a terrific fastball, a wicked slider, and a devastating split.
Bogarts, the tying run at first. In. Kobayashi framed it and tried to bring it back.
Fastball runs inside off the plate. Kobayashi down on one knee to give the umpire a good look over his shoulder.
Two one. Into right center field. That's a hit. Suzuki after it. Racing for third is Bogarts, and he gets there. Ballantyne at first base. 90 feet away, the tying run. The winning run is at first. And had Suzuki not gotten to that ball in the gap, Bogarts would have scored.
What a job by Ballantyne to get to that slider. He knows immediately that it's going to drop for a base hit. He's got a fist pump before he takes off for first. Bogarts goes first to third. Suzuki just in defensively in right field, cuts it off. Ballantyne, his second hit of the night, gives way to the pinch runner.
That's Dwayne Kemp. Versatile utility guy, and he can scoot, so he's at first. Now, the Japanese pitchers tonight, when they've needed a ground ball, have been able to get one, and boy, do they need one here.
Again, here's where that slide rule at second comes into play. You've got the tying run 90 feet away at third base. You bring in a speedy runner. He breaks up a double play, keeps the inning alive. The run comes in and scores. Didi Gregorius with a great chance here in the ninth.
Takahiro Norimoto, a starting pitcher, is in trying to close it for Japan. With one out, infield has come in up the middle. Corners are tight.
Well, that's really interesting. Tension? You don't see this very often, but the Japanese middle infielders not going to play back and play for the double play.
Gregorius, foul. That could have ended it. A ball, a strike, an out, and a run separates Netherlands and Japan at the corners. One out with the infield in, Buck Martinez. Is Bogarts running on contact?
I think so. With Didi Gregorius hitting it, you put the pressure on it, then you got Scope still able to come to the plate. Bogarts getting a big lead off the bag at third.
Here's a 1-1. Fastball up in. And again, these major league hitters, Simmons, Profar, Bogarts, even Ballantyne, who's that caliber of hitter, Gregorius, Scope, they see mid-90s every night. Two one. Good breaking ball. Norimoto evens the count.
This is that split that runs away from Gregorius. Right now with a 2-2 count. Cut your swing down. Hit the ball in the air.
Bogarts at third. Kemp is at first. Norimoto, and time is called by Gregorius.
Once again, Bogarts at third has been reminded, hey, be aware of that ball in the dirt. Norimoto throws a wicked splitter and a hard slider.
Now the 2-2. Fastball, little looper, left field, charging Aoki, tagging his Bogarts. He will stop on a great throw.
Just not deep enough to take a chance. Aoki moved from right to left at the start of this inning. Ball was lined right at him. Bogarts immediately went back to tag. But because it was so sharply hit right at the left fielder, he couldn't take a chance. Bogarts is tagging. Aoki has his momentum going toward the plate and throws a one-hop strike to Kobayashi.
He's out by 20 feet if he keeps running.
Well, another reason you can't chance it on that shallow fly ball is you've got Jonathan Scope coming up next. You still got a shot.
Here is Scope, who's 2 for 4. The Dutch down to their last out. Tying run at third, winning run at first.
Scope taking a shot at that high fastball. Just a bit too high at 95.
Fastball, ground ball, base hit. They've tied it. Kemp is racing for third, and he'll get there. And the Dutch have come back. Jonathan Scope's third hit, and it's 6-6.
That's why you can't gamble on that shallow fly ball to left field. You got a big league hitter coming up next, and Jonathan Scope delivers the game-tying base hit. What a ball game. Scope stays on this fastball. It was just a bit lower than that high fastball he swung through. He homered in the second. Now he ties it up. This ball off the glove of Kikuchi into center field. Bogaerts comes in to score. And Dwayne Kemp goes first to third.
Now Scope is at first, but the winning run is 90 feet away. It's Kurt Smith against Norimoto. And that's a concern for Japan. Kobayashi's done a terrific job all night of smothering fork ball after fork ball.
He's as good as I've seen on balls in the dirt. I mean, he just squares them up and never, ever hesitates to go down to a knee and keep that ball in front of him.
Smith doubled in the sixth, struck out in the eighth. Runner goes and takes second. And some inside heat.
97 miles an hour upstairs.
A fork ball could end it either way, in a strikeout or a wild pitch. On the hands.
Hey, Valentin encouraging Smith to make him get it down, and Smith thinking, what do you mean? I don't have time to make those judgments. It's 97.
Winning run is 90 feet away. Norimoto 1-2 on Kurt Smith. He went. No! Larry Vanover says no swing. Wow. He is still alive, and that was close. Here's a look.
Take another look at that check swing. Boy, he could have been called for a swing. The appeal to first. They don't get the call. 2-2.
A break for the Netherlands. 2-2. Kobayashi is outside now. Might be the splitter. It was, did not go there. Well, you can see the pattern. When Kobayashi sets up out, it's a splitter. When he's in, it's a shuto. Fastball.
I don't know why Norimoto would throw anything other than a fastball here. Got 96, 97.
Three, two. He was set up right down the middle, and it was a fastball.
Kurt Smith came into this round 0 for 7. struggling to the point where the manager, Hensley Mullins, sat him down for game three and said, Kurt, you've got to relax. You're trying too hard.
Thinking too much, Mullins said. Smith right now with a full count and a game on the line. Two outs in the ninth, 3-2 coming. The splitter ends the at bat, ends the inning, but not the game, because the Netherlands strikes for one to the 10th in Tokyo. Now, extra innings beginning with the 11th. Because of the limit on pitchers, this format, this international format, if you get to the 11th, both teams will get an at bat starting an inning with runners at first and second base. There's been extra innings here in the World Baseball Classic, but we haven't seen this happen yet. Kalean Sams is out in right field, and he's now in the cleanup spot. Luke Van Meel, who looked overpowering in the ninth, stays in to pitch the 10th. This is Shogo Akiyama.
Akiyama batting in the eighth spot. Had a good night at the plate.
Left field, deep, twisting, foul. That had enough to get out.
Yeah, it carried a long way to the opposite field. Friend of Odeberg shaded in that direction, ran all the way into the corner, but it sliced into the seats. Akiyama had a sac fly in the second, RBI single in the third. He walked and stole a base in the seventh. Van Meel bounced that splitter in the dirt.
Well, you've got 8-9-1 for Japan. Remember, Japan swept through the first round here in Tokyo. Netherlands came out of Korea at 2-1. None of those wins mean anything here in round two. It's back to pool play, and the best two of these four teams goes on to Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles. Hensley Mullins took the Netherlands to that final round in 13. Bouncer towards second, charging Gregorius, or excuse me, Scope, with a backhand flip in time to get the out. See, I knew I would do that at some point. I would have one of the many shortstops in the wrong spot. But that was Scope, and Akiyama is out number one. Van Meel continues on. There's all sorts of strategy to think about as you get to the 11th. In fact, you can even think about strategy in the 10th if you're headed to the 11th in terms of pinch runners.
There was an extra inning game between Venezuela and Italy today. Venezuela scored a run at the top of the 10th to win 11-10.
That's in the center and a base hit. Again, Simmons is a shortstop that likes to play in the hole. And Japan has found that spot just to the left of second with another soft hit. And Kobayashi has been the guy both times.
His fifth hit of the tournament is 2-for-5 tonight, couple of strikeouts. He drove in a run in the fifth. And Seiichi Uchikawa has grabbed the bat. He's going to come in to hit for the third baseman, Kosuke Tanaka. Uchikawa, a veteran.
Much like their bullpen, Japan's depth on their bench with hitters is impressive as well.
Well, the players here in Japan find it a distinct honor to be playing for Samurai Japan. No matter what their role is, they love the opportunity to represent their country in the World Baseball Classic. Remember, they're two-time champs.
Fujikawa 0 for 3 in the WBC, and he fouls it back.
Fujikawa hit 300 last season with 18 home runs. He drove in 100 runs for the first time in his career. He's 34 years old, and this is his third WBC. He spent 10 seasons with the Yokohama Bay Stars. He's now playing in Fukuoka with SoftBank.
He's been a very good ball, almost gets by. Ricard has been a very good postseason player. He was the MVP of the Japan Series back in 2014. That's the World Series over here equivalent. Big moments in the World Baseball Classic as well. Hit 348 4 years ago with a home run. So he's on the big stage here in the Big Egg, as they call the Tokyo Dome. And Mill misses out.
Fujikawa had a home run in each of the last two WBCs. He hit over 300 in both of those series. His first 100 RBI season came in his 16th season.
Fujikawa with one out in the 10th. 6-6, Japan and Netherlands. Just a great ball game here tonight. One of the things you find out when you have a sellout here and you walk out after the game, there really isn't a lot of traffic because just about everybody is headed to trains. And hopefully they keep those trains running late tonight.
It is Sunday night, and you can see some of the seats have started to empty out. 11:20 here, and some of those trains will be the last opportunity for these fans to get home.
Runner goes, it's fouled back. I get the distinct impression that most of the people here just don't care about getting home.
Yeah, you call in sick, say I was at a baseball game, and your boss might understand.
Because there are some empty seats, but not many. And they're still loud. They have been rocking this place since just before first pitch. It's a 7 o'clock Tokyo time game. It is now 11:20 here in Tokyo. 3-2, little blooper down the line. It's gonna fall. Odomer has to charge. Kobayashi stops at third. And Fujikawa, a bleeder, but a double.
The veteran Fujikawa coming off the bench takes a big swing, hits it off the end of the bat, but flares it into shallow left field. Kobayashi running from first, alertly moves over to third. Fujikawa ends up at second. Right off the end of the bat, just a little flare down the left field line. By the time Odomer gets it in, it's second and third, one out. Fujikawa, one of the veterans on this team, delivers a big hit.
Matsuda,
who has had a great offensive tournament, comes in as the pinch runner.
And the Netherlands going to go to their bullpen. 6-6 in the 10th. This white knuckle ride takes another turn here. Japan and Netherlands 6-6. Tom Stoifbergen into the ball game. And the Netherlands will intentionally walk Ryosuke Kikuchi to load the bases. And the guy that's on deck has been terrific all night. He's 2 for 3, Nori Aoki, and he's been on base 4 of 5 times. Stoibergen becomes the 6th reliever for Hensley Mullins and Bert Blyleven.
What a ball game. A little bit of everything in this game. Nakata hit a 3-run home run. The Netherlands has hit 2 home runs. Jonathan Schoop tied it up in the bottom of the 9th with a 2-out base hit. And now Japan has the bases loaded and 1 out.
Remember, Japan is not the home team in this game. This is top 10. Aoki, 2 hits, 2 walks, and a strikeout. And if the inning stays alive, if there's no double play, you've got an at bat coming up. Remember, it's not Sasugo who's on deck, it's Suzuki who came in defensively. Infield halfway up the middle. In fact, Profar was actually somewhat deep while Schoop was up, and now they get their signals on the same page. Aoki's a tough man to double up. Stoibergen fouls it off his foot.
Even on a comebacker, they're going to have to go home, man. Where Simmons is now, he and Bogaerts continue to talk about what they'll do if a ball is slowly hit. Simmons has a cannon for an arm at shortstop. Bogaerts is in between first and second. He's in a tough spot. If he gets a hot shot, he can come home.
That's a strike. And it's 1 and 2.
Bogaerts at third, of course. Schoop at second. Too many shortstops on the infield.
I hear you, brother. I hear you. But they're all good, and that's adds just another element to this. 1 and 2 to Aoki. Just missed. Stoibergen reacted, but it was well out. .63, .270 is Stoibergen. Of course he's 6'3" and .270.
He's from the Netherlands.
Bouncer, Schoop, Simmons, they got the double play. How about that? Well, if anybody could do it, it's Schoop and Simmons, and they just did. And credit Smith for staying on the base and getting the double play.
They had talked about what they were going to do, but Schoop shovels to Simmons, who uses that strong arm to get the inning-ending double play.
All right, let's regroup. Nobuhiro Matsuda is at third base, and Kazuhisa Makita, the submariner, comes in for Japan. And boy, is he tough to hit. You can see by the numbers. Last year. And he pumps in a strike to the catcher, Dashenko Ricardo. You've got Randolph Odeber, and then Andrelton Simmons for the Dutch. And of course, we're 3 outs away from getting to the 11th, and for the first time in WBC history, experiencing that game shortening 11th inning situation, where each team gets an at bat with runners at first and second to start an inning. And the rules are that the two guys, the two hitters that are just in front of the scheduled hitter are the base runners. And if Makita throws like that, we're headed to the 11th, because that's nasty.
He gets the strikeout, first batter here in the bottom of the 10th, and here are the rules regarding extra innings. Starting in the 11th, the inning starts with runners on first and second. The batter scheduled to hit will lead off, and the two previous hitters will take their spots on first and second, respectively, in the order in which they hit.
That was a Jeff Nelson-like frisbee slider that floated by Odubor, who tried to bunt. Nelson, of course, the longtime sidearmer for the Yankees and the Mariners. That one fouled off, and it's 0-2, and you can see why this guy is so successful at the end of a game. He is the eighth reliever to work for Japan.
Upstairs, just 81 miles an hour, because you're focused so much on that release point. When he does elevate a fastball, it really gets on you quickly.
Jam shot.
It is really important for a submariner like Makita to throw a lot of strikes. You don't want to give the hitters enough pitches to make the adjustment on the unusual release point. Pound that strike zone early. Get quick results.
Odubor went all the way to the ground with it, just to make sure it would stay down on the ground. It wouldn't magically come back up like a frisbee slider can. Japan has 13 pitchers on their roster. This is the ninth to work, including the starter. Odubor reaches out, pokes it. Kikuchi flips to first. And here comes Andrelton Simmons. Well, you know, the thing that you do now, obviously Japan has to get Simmons out, but you look at the two guys that made the last outs and what kind of speed they have, and Japan clearly has the advantage here, because Kikuchi and Aoki would be running to start the 11th.
Good point.
Simmons fouls it back to the screen.
Yeah, to start the 11th, you would have Kikuchi at second, Aoki at first.
And here is Simmons. Ricardo and Odubor are the first two outs. And there's that 80 miles an hour that looks like 92 or 93. Well, he set up out. Kobayashi did. And Makita hit him right in the glove. If it gets there. Simmons saw it off. And you know what? We are there. To the 11th, and for the first time for you and me and everybody, we're headed to a interesting 11th. So, beginning with the 11th inning, the team at bat starts with runners at first and second base. Both teams get an at bat. The runner on first is in the batting order immediately preceding the hitter, and then you go to the next guy who ends up at second base. And so everybody is experiencing this probably for the first time. It does happen occasionally in international play, so there might be a few players, especially on the Netherlands, that may have seen this or heard about this from guys that have run into it in an international tournament.
Remember, Seiya's Suzuki came into the game defensively in right field. Aoki moved from right to left, so Tsutsugo, who was hitting in this spot in the lineup, is not at the plate.
It's Suzuki, and he bunts. Stoifbergen has it, fires the first in time. You really had to expect Japan to bunt. They love little ball. it can be an advantage to be the home team in this case, which the Netherlands is, because much like, say, in college football, when you have the tiebreaker, you want to be on defense to see what you are really need to get rather than what you want to get. And so now you've got the two runners, Kikuchi, who has speed, Aoki, he has speed. They are now at second and third. Here is Nakata. Netherlands will get an at bat in this fashion as well, and a strike from Stoifbergen.
And this is kind of interesting. Why wouldn't you load the bases in this situation to put the double play in order? Second and third, one out, and Sho Nakata got off to a fast start. He doubled and homered in his first two at bats. 0 for 3 since.
Line drive, base hit, left field. It'll score both runs. Kikuchi, Aoki. And of course, it's Nakata. And the bunt works. Now remember, the Netherlands will get the same at bat, first and second, and nobody out. But they need outs here. They need to limit the damage.
Well, the Netherlands turned a big double play to end the 10th inning. A little surprised they chose to pinch to Nakata with the base open. You can put him on, put the double play in order, and you might be able to get a ground ball and get out of the inning. As you can see, Team Japan out onto the playing surface after Nakata comes through. Again, another big hit for the veteran Nakata. He's driven in 5 runs.
Sakamoto takes a rip and fouls it off. Stoifbergen out of a Dutch bullpen that has been emptied almost. Markwell, Martise, Bolsenbroek, DeBlock. That's in the left field. Odeber has it. First and second. And one out.
Great Bergen. Sacrifice bunt, 2-run single, a base hit by Sakamoto, and now you've got the number 7 hitter, Yamada. He is 1 for 4 with a walk, struck out in each of his last 2 plate appearances.
First and second, one out, 2 runs across in the 11th.
This is where it's very important that the Netherlands keeps it a 2-run deficit. When you look to the bottom of the 11th, it'll be Profar and Bogaerts to lead things off with 2 runners on.
Ground ball, Bogaerts, Scope's turn, a rocket from Scope, my goodness. And he turns the double play. But the Dutch have work to do. The Dutch will have first and second and nobody out. Down 2 in the 11th.
We'll lead things off. He's batting second. Bogaerts is behind him.
All right, so, and Makita is still on the mound. You got Profar, you got Bogaerts. Kalia Sams is due up third. Are you bunting here?
I think it's tough to bunt in this situation and give away Profar's at bat.
Now, the Japanese didn't blink. They went bunt, and it paid off. They got 2 runs. But you're right. You got Profar. They might walk Bogaerts and pitch to Sams.
Then you lose both of your potent at bats.
And Profar, a big swing, pops it up, infield fly. Well, that... ends that discussion.
Well, I agree with that strategy as well. You got 2 of your better hitters up in a situation. I don't think you can give up Profar's at bat by asking him to bunt. Then, like you say, they put Bogaerts on, bases loaded for Killian Sams, who hasn't had an at bat yet. He took over defensively in right field after Ballantyn was lifted for the pinch runner.
The Dutch had all kinds of problems with Mikita in the 10th. A submariner with that frisbee slider. And Bogaerts stands in. A rare fastball misses, and it's 1-0. So the Netherlands needs two, at the very least, to keep this game going. Three wins it. Simmons is a trail runner. Odubor at second. And he came in and got a strike. Didn't get that call, and he stayed fastball with Bogaerts.
Bogaerts has enough power to end this thing. He had 21 home runs in a regular season.
Outfield is exceptionally deep.
They have played their outfield deep late in the ball game.
There's the frisbee. And it came in at 70.
That spinning breaking ball has a tendency to look like it's going up and away from you. Bogaerts thought it was off the plate outside.
See what he gets here. 2-2. That is out further. You could see Kobayashi tried to bring it back, and the count's full, 3-2. A lot of tension, and it's been that way from the very start of this one. We're almost 5 hours in. 3-2. Jammed him back to the screen.
You know, you mentioned the strategy in this situation on a full count. Do you chance starting the runners?
It's all part of it. You have Sams on deck. But after him, then you get Gregorius and Scope.
Yeah.
Bogaerts ready, 3-2. Bounce to third. Out there, and that's it. The inning is still alive. But now the Netherlands down to their last outs. And here is Sams. We told you earlier, with all the star power that the Netherlands has, there are some guys whose names you don't know that have had big hits to help in their success. This guy hit the walk-off sacrifice fly that beat Cuba in 2013.
This will be his first at bat of the tournament. He came on defensively, taking over in right. He did not have an at bat in Korea.
So Bogaerts is the runner at first. Odubor is now at third. Simmons was erased. I have no idea how to keep a scorebook for this. One oh pitch. Sams dumps it. Foul.
Well, as far as the pitching stats go, the runners are placed on base as if there was an error committed, but there's not an error charge, so there won't be any earned runs, but that's kind of academic. That doesn't mean much in this situation. Netherlands trying to tie it up here in the bottom of the 11th.
Top of the 11th. Japan had runners first and second, nobody out. They bunted and they scored two. Fastball is in and it's 2-1. Netherlands gets the same situation. They put runners out first and second. Nobody out, but things haven't gone as well for the Dutch. No one has scored. Runners at the corners, now two outs. Sams takes in. After Sams, you've got Didi Gregorius. Three and one. Makita ready. Jammed him again.
Sam's fighting it off.
And as you pointed out, he hasn't had an at bat in the tournament, but he's seen everything that Makita has during this at bat.
Again, the outfield is so deep with two outs. And he certainly hasn't had a very good swing just yet.
3-2. Pops it up behind the plate. Kobayashi, Japan wins it in 11. Kazuhisa Makita shuts the door. And what a game and what a scene tonight in Tokyo.
Sho Nakata, the veteran first baseman, had a big night. He drives in five. Got the big hit in the 11th. The tie rules into play for the first time. Runners at first and second, nobody out to start the inning, and Nakata delivers the game-winning single.
Israel stunned Cuba to start the day. Japan outlasts the Dutch to end it, and they do it in the new 11th inning format by picking up two runs. And Japan goes to 1-0. The Netherlands at 0-1. Where the Dutch had their opportunities. This was a back and forth affair with a lot of power shows. Scope, Nakata, Valentin. And in the end, a few base hits here or there. And a big one by Nakata in the 11th. Japan wins it. For Buck Martinez, our entire crew, great day and night here in Tokyo. I'm Rich Waltz. We'll see you tomorrow night.